You're listening to the Electronic Media Collective Podcast Network. Yeah, it's a mouthful. For more great shows like the one you're about to enjoy, visit electronicmediacollective.com. And now, our feature presentation.
This is Randy. In the future, neighborhoods will be swarming with heartthrob teenage ninjas.
This is Melanie, and in the future, comic book creators and game creators will collaborate to create the most epic comic book video games.
And this is Jesse. In the future, if you build it, a bedlam post-apocalyptic future will come.
Thank you for joining us. This is the Grawlix Podcast, episode number 19. Pause for Melanie's response.
Say, are we going to do this exactly the same?
It's done. No, I didn't think it was really going to go that way. And we're excited to be here. We got a little case of deja vu for a couple reasons.
Yeah.
This is our second take on episode number 19. Luckily, we didn't get too far into the first take. That's some sausage, how the sausage is made information. Behind the scenes, how the sausage is made.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, except in the internet, we make links.
Yeah. Yo. Oh. Yo.
Oh, boy. Never sausage a thing coming.
Oh, wow. See? It's so. I'm so glad we didn't have these puns the first time around.
No,
right,
no.
We didn't.
This is good. And also, it's a little deja vu because we were just recording last night.
Yes.
We recorded an interview with John Mueller, author, illustrator of Oink, Heaven's Butcher, and video game art director, amongst other things, like Heartthrob Ninjas. And that will already have been up on the website for a while. If you haven't checked it out, you've got to go listen to that interview. It was fantastic.
You won't understand Heartthrob Ninjas unless you do.
Yeah, exactly. And we're not going to explain it, so you got to go listen to the interview. It's totally
inside.
Worth it.
This is going to be the inside joke episode, so yep. Go ahead and download that other episode first.
So now we're gonna reference every episode we've ever done. Yeah. No, that was. I mean, we've already kind of talked about this, but that was a great interview. We've been very fortunate to interview a lot of great people, and it was another one that really hit that area where you're like, this person is super cool. I just want to sit here and have a real conversation with them, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Totally our kind of people, I think.
Yeah. Oh, definitely, yeah.
But maybe they're listening and like, I'm not your kind of people. I just wanted to be nice for
I'm
your
just
podcast.
Really good at faking your kind of people.
Yeah.
That's good.
Before we forget, John Mueller has a Kickstarter going on right now, and it's fully funded, so there's no risk. If you are interested in his work, you should back it and get that Icon edition, or at least the hardcover edition, because all sorts of stretch goals are unlocked, and there's all sorts of awesome goodies that are going to come along with that. That probably are Kickstarter exclusives.
Mm-hmm. I want the Icon edition.
Yeah, that looks pretty slick.
Yeah, it's really nice presentation.
Comes with a slip cover and a foil stamped like spine and all sorts of stuff.
Oh, and it's like he was saying in the interview, which you should totally go listen to, listener. Because you're a listener. Go listen.
Yeah. That's your job. You had one job, listener.
Do it.
Please. We like you. Come back next month.
We like you. Come back again. They are the oversized hardcovers. And it's like he was saying, just that extra bit of the extra, what, inch, 2 inches of page area. Mm-hmm. And then also being able to actually open the book flat, so it lays flat, so you can actually see
without worrying that you're going to break the glue on the spine or anything like that.
And this is, I mean, we read a lot of good looking comic books, but this is definitely one of those where you want to take the time and study the pages because the artwork is amazing and the character design is is bonkers. It's a really good looking book. So,
and each page is a painting.
Yeah.
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 It's awesome.
We endorse it.
Yeah.
Officially. And we're not really, you know, we're not getting anything out of it. We're just, we endorse it.
We got a rad interview and that's enough for us.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So if you want to buy us off,
you just come on the show.
And you better be cool.
Just be awesome. That's all.
Better have crazy stories. Better talk to us about Mad Max Fury Road.
That was awesome. I didn't even see that coming, but that was awesome.
But we also since the last episode, you also talked to movie fan Jen.
Yes.
That's how you can find her on Tumblr anyway. You had a great interview with somebody who comes from the Marvel movie fandom from a different angle, which I thought was pretty cool.
Yeah, she hasn't really gotten into the comics yet. I think that it sounds like she's very interested in delving into those stories so that she has even more background on it. But she is essentially a super fan of the movie universe, which, we're seeing a lot of that happen. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's valid. I mean, those movies help to keep the interest in these characters going into the next, you know, how many ever decades that, you know, people like to read about superheroes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that is also up on the website as the, and if you subscribe or you're on iTunes, they show up as the Grawlix Knights. Mm-hmm. And if you don't know by now, those are generally our interview episodes. So mm-hmm. we like to brand those different to keep them separate because they're special.
So yep. special.
They're special.
Special, locked safe in our heart. Yeah. I don't know why it's locked.
Because it's valuable.
Yeah. And it makes a good combination.
Oh, like a lock, right?
Like a lock, yeah.
My heart is a high school locker.
Secret.
High school locker.
Locker. If that's the case, then I'm gonna have to go back to the office and get my combination a couple times because I'm gonna forget.
Yeah, I had to have the janitor come and cut my lock off because it was gone.
I don't think I ever had that problem. Really? And I'm terrible with numbers, but I never had that problem.
Yeah,
I was bad. At least once a quarter, I was like, "Hey, what's my locker combination again?" Because I forgot it.
I just quit. I quit using my locker. I just carried every book I had, and then I got back problems.
Oh, do it! Yeah,
those textbooks.
Those are books. Those books are big.
Yeah, they add up quick.
And now I think they just issue an iPad and say, "Why aren't you here? Why aren't you at class on time? You just have an iPad."
And then you have to make up an excuse because you can't tell them you were
breaking
out.
I couldn't get my locker open. You don't need a locker. You have an iPad.
You have an iPad.
What were you putting your coat on? yeah, that's me, the teacher now.
Oh yeah, you know what? I didn't.
Yeah, you were. Yeah,
I didn't even connect that, but yeah, totally.
Yeah, you had to go to the bathroom 3 times. I know. I don't want to hear about your bladder for the next half hour.
Jesse takes his professional frustrations out
on a very special Grawlix podcast. Sit down, kids. No, the pencil's sharp enough.
Pencils are never sharp enough.
Never. Clearly not.
What are we talking about today? We're going to talk about The Crow.
Yes.
Yep.
The original graphic novel.
Uh-huh.
And we'll probably talk about The Crow movie a little bit. The original Crow movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And then maybe some Doctor Who, because that happens, especially when we don't have anything else to talk about.
Right.
And we are so close. We're on the last season.
I mean, oh.
We have the TV movie after that, but we're so close to being finished. Mm-hmm. And I asked Melanie, I was like, so what are you going to do when we're done with all this Doctor Who? And she said she was going to cry.
Yep.
Oh.
I will.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've started listening to the audio plays since I kind of know all the Doctors yet. I'm avoiding the Eighth Doctor, obviously, but.
Sure.
That's a whole nother chunk of
Doctor Who
time. to listen to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I've been enjoying them so far.
They are sneaky and really good at their marketing, because they will just do these random deals. Like this weekend, they did a deal because they were featured in Doctor Who magazine, and they did a big interview with Colin Baker, because they're kind of redoing the regeneration. Like in the television series, he just kind of regenerates at the beginning of the season, kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like they crash land and boom, regeneration kind of thing. And so he didn't get a proper like send off story. And so Big Finish has decided that they're going to do that. And so that's coming up. And along with that, they also had several of the most like this year's best kind of thing. And they had those on sale this weekend. And I couldn't not like pick up something. they had the fifth Doctor box set was on sale, and I wish I would have got that, but instead I went with the Philip Hinchcliffe series that they did with the fourth Doctor. I'm kind of excited and interested to start those.
The fourth Doctor audio plays are super exciting, because Tom Baker seemed totally uninterested in doing anything like that for a long time.
Right.
And they convinced him to do, I don't know which one, but do something. And it seemed like he really enjoyed doing it. And after that, it was
kind of revitalized him. It's been pretty cool to have him back in audio form. I'm like, it's tough because he's my doctor, but at the same time, when it comes to Big Finish, it's almost like I avoid him. Unless there's a really good sale on his stuff, because he had like so much time on the television, whereas some of the other Big Finish doctors did not. So a lot of times I'm like, well, I come to Big Finish to experience these guys that didn't get that much time.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So, but I really enjoy his work too. I mean, it's fantastic.
I've been enjoying the audio plays, just the few I've started listening to, completed listening to. I've listened to Adventures with, I'm trying to get the numbers right in my head, 6 and 7,
mm-hmm.
And there was an adventure with 5, 6, and 7, and those are awesome.
Where they have multiple doctors?
Yeah, yeah. I can't remember. It was one of the really early, like, main range monthly Big Finish audio plays. Had all three of them together for a large chunk of it.
I'm stuck on like Zagreus. I've kind of jumped all over the Big Finish like timeline, but mm-hmm. Zagreus is coming up, and I believe during that it's a big crossover between 5, 6, 7, and 8.
Ooh. Oh, nice.
Because technically like an eighth Doctor story, but he's kind of like possessed almost, or I don't know. And so apparently the other Doctors are going to get involved or something. I don't know.
Well, those stories are fun for me because they kind of they highlight and embrace the differences between the mm-hmm. Doctors, and there are large differences. And when they do that, it kind of makes me appreciate even the aspects of some of those doctors that I didn't really care for initially. I'm like, well, that really does make him unique. Mm-hmm. And it's an interesting trait. And it's cool that they have the chance in the audio plays to explore those differences a bit more than the show would have.
Yeah.
So, right.
I've been enjoying them. Pretty awesome. So, well, before we dive too far into anything like that. Oh, and I also have a webcomic recommendation. I know.
What? Awesome.
I need to get on that.
Well, yeah.
I have a big list of them, and I look at them, and then I never remember to write anything down.
Well, I just have one. I figured it's been a little while since we did one, and I found a fantastic app on the phone that lets me browse webcomic websites so that the creators don't get, what's a term I can use? So the creators don't get ripped off when it comes to their advertising or, you know, views on their websites and stuff like that.
Right.
Because most of the time, if they make money, that's how they do it. That's like the only way they really, you know, see any kind of return on that. And I guess quite a while ago, there was some controversy with some apps that would just straight rip the the comic images from the site, and and that's shady. That's not a good thing. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I found an app that's basically just a web browser, but they have lots of web comic sites indexed, and then you can save your favorites and go right back to where you left off. So that's helped me to read more web comics.
Mm-hmm. I think that's one that I that I've connected to, isn't it?
I believe so. I found Tank Monkey on there, and I added it to my favorites.
Sweet.
I think it's I don't want to get it wrong, but my phone's charging. I think it's Comics Rocket or something like that. I should double check, but
Comics Rock.
It. Yep.
It is Comic Rocket.
Comic Rocket.
Comic Rocket.
Yeah.
I was gonna say, I've got a button for it on my site.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's what it is then.
I didn't realize that they had an app, which is cool. That's good.
Yeah, and it'll be real helpful for the comics that are very linear. Because I always forget where it ended.
Yeah.
And then I have to spend a half hour searching through trying to find the right spot to start again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like their bookmarking feature is pretty nice.
Mm-hmm.
Another one that a lot of people are liking is Taptastic. And I have not used that app, but I know that a lot of webcomic creators are pretty happy with it. And it formats really well. That's another one if you're interested in finding some webcomics and reading them on your phone.
Well, and I know we've talked a little bit about webcomic apps and stuff before, but then when I went to search them up, of course, all that information was gone. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I'm glad though, because I don't do a lot of comics reading on the computer.
Mm-hmm.
I'm either working on something or distracted by social media.
That never happens. What?
But on my phone, during downtime during the day, or if I just get into something, I've always got my phone on me. So that's just very convenient. Even if it's not the ideal way to read most comics because of the screen size and stuff, but it's handy.
It is handy.
Let's do a webcomic recommendation.
All right.
Yeah, let's do it.
Do it.
I'm going to do a quick shout out for a webcomic called Picpak Dog. Recently, Kim Belding's comic, Picpak Dog, went on a hiatus, and several of the webcomic creators banded together under the hashtag #VivaPicPak and did a lot of fun fan art just to kind of help him bolster while he's on his hiatus. And Picpak Dog is, first of all, you can find it by going to www.picpak.net. And Picpak is actually spelled PICPAK.net. And it's kind of it's your traditional comic strip style, and it's heavily influenced by, the classics like Garfield. And I enjoy it because he does a lot of wordplay in his strips, and so you're going to see a lot of puns and I can't imagine I can't imagine our listeners haven't picked up on the fact that I like puns by now. so I recommend it, and I chipped in with some of the Viva Picpak with the event, and that was all kind of put on by John Esparza, who has been this is like a double shout out, because John Esparza has been one of our web comic recommendations in the past, and he kind of lined this whole thing up. So, and he's also kind of one of our most consistent retweeters. Mm-hmm, so thank you, John. And check out Picpak Dog. Check out what Kim's up to. He's one of those people that he's really helpful with creators. Like if you have a question, he's just very generous with his time and his experience. Picpak Dog.
And as usual, we will include links to everything in the show notes.
Yes.
So any cool thing that we talk about, we make sure to link them up so you can find them easily, because I mean, why else would we recommend it if we don't want you to check it out?
'Cause sausage.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right, and my webcomic recommendation, this is probably, I don't know, this is probably well known. I started reading Remind, R-E-M-I-N-D, and this is one of those that, and I, that is totally like graphic novel released in webcomic form, and I believe the intent was for it to be a graphic novel, and it is complete. In fact, you can buy, it's collected into two volume books. But anyway, this is a graphic novel slash webcomic by Jason Brubaker. Basically, he does graphic novels like this. He's got some other ones that I'll have to check out sometime, but I haven't finished Remind yet. And he also works at DreamWorks Animation in the visual department.
Oh.
Yeah, he's got an IMDb page.
Yeah, yeah. The graphic novel thing is like his nights and weekends type thing.
Mm-hmm.
What was it? By day, his bio said by day he works at DreamWorks, and by night he, you know, makes...
He works on his dream.
Good. Yeah. Whoa. Nice. That's wordplay.
Nicely done.
So I'll just go ahead and kind of read his description on the website about it, because he puts it much more succinctly than I would. Remind is a mystical sci-fi tale. Mm-hmm. I'm adding tale. About faith, love, and brain transplantation. Sonia, the lighthouse keeper at a seaside oil drilling town, loses her cat, Victuals. Is it Victuals? It's interesting name. Everyone blames the lizard man, a local boogeyman, which Sonia knows is a myth created by her own father, by her late father, to generate interest in the town. But when Victuals unexpectedly returns and has the brains of a strange, intelligent creature, it seems someone is doing experimental transplants. It actually goes on a little further, but...
Mm-hmm.
And it's pretty early on that you find out more, but I don't want to, you know, I don't want to spoil that.
Yeah, it sounds awesome.
The artwork is very cool looking. Like, the characters have kind of a stylized look. I love the look of the cat. It's like a cat, but it's a very...
it's very stylized and cartoony looking,
yeah,
based on the cover.
Yeah.
Like Felix the cat, but not quite.
Yeah, exactly. That's totally the look the cat has. But the artwork is very glossy and very very polished. It looks very good. The coloring is good. He does really cool stuff with lighting. And it's stylized, but it's interesting. It's an interesting cross between, you do have like kind of these cartoony characters. The cat looks cartoony.
Mm-hmm.
When you first start reading it, the cat's just a normal cat, does cat things. At the same time, people don't look super cartoony, maybe a little anime-ish, that might be wrong to say, but... And then eventually you get this cat has something happen to it, and it starts talking to her. Mm-hmm. So...
I'm all about talking cats.
I know. I wanted to mention it now for you, because mm-hmm. I think you'd enjoy it quite a bit. Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's hard to nail down exactly the tone. It feels like it has emotion behind it. It's also kind of amusing. There's definitely some mystery elements early on.
Just doing a quick search on him. He won a Zurich Award for Remind, and he's also one of the founders of makingcomics.com, which I actually have tooled around on the site and didn't realize he was involved in it at all. But it's a pretty good site. It's a comics education site where you can get lots of different tips and tricks.
I figured this was probably not an obscure webcomic I was grabbing.
I can't claim that I'd heard of it, but apparently it's been around since 2011. Mm-hmm. That's where he started his career in graphic novels, according mm-hmm. to makingcomics.com.
Mm-hmm.
And he works at DreamWorks Animation and Visual Development on many movies, including every Kung Fu Panda movie.
Yeah. Yep. I think it said he's been working in visual in, I think, for DreamWorks since like 96.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, I mean, it makes sense that the art's so good. Mm-hmm. Like, he's obviously a talented guy, and I've been enjoying the story writing of Remind. And like I said, it's complete. So if it sounds cool, you can go and read the whole thing for free, or you can buy the books, or read the whole thing for free and then buy the books because you loved it. And he's got other stuff that I'm excited to check out after I get through.
Cythra? Looks like it's another project that he's working on.
I liked it because it had kind of, like, at times kind of a light tone, but also it felt like it had not necessarily, like, a gritty tone, but, like, there's, like, a dark side. There's a mystery.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like there's how do they put it in right? There's things at stake, you know?
Hmm.
So, interesting characters. I really dug it. So I recommend Remind. You can read that at remindblog.com. It's remindblog.com. It's been a while since I had a webcomic recommendation. I think this is a good one.
Thanks, baby.
Looks like it's got a couple awards going to that website. So awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Award-winning work.
Yep.
Yep.
And he worked on a bunch of Kung Fu Panda. I bet he was a heartthrob teenage ninja, too.
Skidoosh. What's the line? The awesomeness is free. The awesomeness and attractiveness is free. Something to that. Yep. Awkward Kung Fu Panda quotes. That's what we do here.
I've never actually watched any of them.
No.
I'm sure you've probably seen a bunch.
Well,
how many are there? Like 2, 3, 7?
Oh, there's a series.
Oh, of course there is.
At least 2, and then there's like the Furious 7 or something. Like they have spinoff shorts.
I've seen enough that I do the phase out, you know, thing.
Oh yeah. Just let it play.
Yeah.
It's like it's keeping children quiet.
Yeah.
I guess we could just jump into The Crow.
we buried the lead. We're like, hey, this is The Crow episode. Doctor Who, Kung Fu Panda, webcomics. The Crow.
Jump in it.
All right, we're going to be talking about the original Crow. This is our pull list pick. Wait a second. We can't do our pull list pick without announcing our previous pull list pick winner.
That's right. So...
We almost forgot.
I think I know who it is.
I bet you do.
I bet I do.
Oh, yeah. I think they won hands down.
Yeah.
Yeah. Several hands down.
Yeah. all the hands down need to get their hands up for an internet high five.
So, without a doubt, the winner. Our pull list pick, it's weird to say winner. What if they won? We will talk about it.
Yeah.
We'll read it too.
Yeah, that's true.
I guess we better.
So our pull list pick for next episode, we will be reading this month and talking about it next episode, is Herald, Lovecraft, and Tesla.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Which, oh, I should have more information
about
it.
It's got like 72% of our votes right now.
Yeah.
It won a little.
It came out of nowhere and dominated.
Yeah.
And, but, I mean, should we talk about why?
Well, first...
Yeah, oh yeah, totally.
Okay.
I want to encourage more of that kind of shenanigan.
Yeah, me too. I enjoyed it. Well, since it like came out of nowhere and blew everything away... We were like, what is somebody gaming us? What's going on?
Yeah. Is it like the same person voting over and over and over?
Yeah, which shouldn't
be fine because you can only, what, vote once
a week. So you can vote multiple times. We're okay with that, except it's supposed to be like IP restricted. So you can only vote once a week because we don't want one person dominating all the time.
Right.
But this had a ton of votes in less than a week.
Mm-hmm.
So we were like, what is going on?
Yeah. We thought we were hacked.
Yeah.
By Tesla. If anyone could do it, it would be Tesla.
That's true. He built some kind of Jacob's ladder to hack into our system. That's what they call those things, right?
All you needed was an alternating current.
Yep.
You cracked the code, Tesla.
Maybe he reversed the polarity.
Oh, no.
That's all you need to do, usually.
Yeah, that works every time. So in researching what this book was, we come across its Facebook page and a post in which they somehow come across our poll and was like, hey, I believe they call their readers cultists. They're like, hey, yeah. Cultists, check this out. Make this happen.
Yeah, vote for us. Yeah.
So, yeah, they called their fan base in to vote on our poll so that we would talk about it. And that is totally okay. We enjoy that quite a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And really, we're kind of hoping once we read this and become fans ourselves, maybe their fans can become our fans.
I think that should happen, yeah. We haven't even read it, and we like the idea, so.
Oh, yeah. God, Tesla and Lovecraft? How could you not like that?
What would you call us, then? Like, we're not quite cultists yet.
What are the possible recruits, I guess?
Pledges.
Pledges, yeah. we're pledges. And so we actually talked to the creators just a little bit. And, you know, we congratulated them, like, well, good job. Well done.
Yeah, yeah. And they were like, well, we don't call them cultists for nothing.
Yep. So that was fun. And the book looks pretty cool. And I don't know how they come across our page, but what a cool thing to where I'd never heard of this. It's an indie independent published book. We'll be talking about the first six issues of the series, which actually covers their first two volumes. They collect three issues per trade. The first volume is out already. The second volume, I think, will be out. I'll have to double check when we actually record next month, but it'll be out like a month after we next episode goes live, or so, maybe a month and a half, 2 months.
When I think that we mentioned it last month because it had one vote or something. And we were like, what's this? This sounds interesting. And then boom.
Yeah. It popped up, and before it dominated, it caught our eye because just on the title alone.
Yeah.
And then it blew up, and we're like, oh, well, awesome. Yeah. cool. We were into it.
Yeah. Well, and I mentioned it to Dave, who was on episode 18. The motorcycle clown gang. I mentioned it to him, and he had heard of it. So usually when Dave has heard of something, I am like, okay, let's take a look at this, because Dave has good taste in clown humor magic.
And motorcycle riding dogs.
Yeah, yeah.
Excited for that. This month, however, we're gonna time travel a little bit. We're going back to 1989.
Oh, my hair.
And man.
oh, my hair.
It felt like the 80s.
Yep.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
So we're going to talk about The Crow, written and illustrated by James O'Barr, published in 1989. This is obviously not a... although I'm sure up until the movie came out, this was not a mainstream book. But... then there were movies, and so this is definitely a property people recognize. For myself, I don't think you guys have read it either. I'm not sure, but I've never read it. I've seen the first movie a million times.
I think I had read it not long after I saw the movie, but again, we're talking about how long ago was that?
The movie came out in like 94.
Yeah.
So it was a little while ago.
Yeah.
I'd never read any Crow, anything. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I've seen the first movie a million times. I've never seen any of the sequels.
You can watch all of them on Netflix.
Oh, they're on Netflix?
I don't necessarily recommend all of them, but I actually turned it on today while I was getting ready for the show, kind of puttering around. And so that's how I know. But yeah, I think there's four movies now, and all four of them are on Netflix.
Oh, we watched the first one. So yeah. I imagine we will talk about that a little bit. It'll be kind of hard not to mention it while we're talking about the comic book, but...
Right.
And that's okay. I think a little bit like Walking Dead, how I'd prefer to do it is focus mainly on the comic book while we're talking about it, to be fair to it, of course. And then we could probably, after that, expand into the book versus the movie and stuff like that. So, what did you guys think of The Crow?
I liked it, but I knew, unless it was completely different, I knew I was going to like it.
Right. I'd second that. And I liked it. I like the artwork, and I think he has, I can't remember where I read it, but it was like kind of a, he has like a specialization in like Renaissance style anatomy and artwork.
Oh,
and,
that makes sense.
I think you can kind of see that in the idealized nature of some of the poses mm-hmm. and stuff. Like he really, I think he really excels at some of those anatomy, you know, shots that he does.
Well, I think there's definitely two styles of artwork going on throughout
this
book.
Oh, yeah. I'd agree with that, yeah.
There's the obviously more comic book style action scenes and the murder scenes and stuff like that where the crow sometimes looks stylized in his proportions, but the bad guys definitely have like stylized look to them. Mm-hmm. Some of them have very round heads, stuff like that, you know?
Yeah.
And then you've got, and it's a lot of the scenes where the crow's in the house thinking about kind of flashbacks and stuff like that. And that stuff is where it's like,
that's much more painterly or
yeah.
Almost like ink wash type of thing.
It looks like, I mean, the proportions and the anatomy is so close. It looks like he was maybe going by reference pictures.
Mm-hmm.
And I could be wrong, but and I don't think the styles clash. I think it works. Mm-hmm. I just thought that was one of the things that really stood out to me. It's very interesting, these two different styles, and it weaves back mm-hmm. and forth. And they're clearly like different. Like, yeah. Even the way it's a black and white book, and even the way it's kind of inked, some of it almost looks like it's just pencil or just pen drawings. And then mm-hmm. some of it looks more traditionally inked in a way.
Mm-hmm.
So that's definitely interesting. And I didn't know he had kind of that background.
Right.
So it makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of them are really like heavy spot blacks,
mm-hmm.
Where he'll do like almost like a negative kind of thing, where it's everything's in black except for the highlights are kind of carved out.
Mm-hmm.
Like one scene in particular, and one of my favorites in terms of the art, is when he goes after Fun Boy, and like I guess I assume it's Gabriel, but he has all these cats that just start showing up on the staircase. And they're all just kind of done in silhouette.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot more cats than I knew there
were. Yeah, way more cats.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the cats, the cat thing was interesting.
And the talking crow itself, like I didn't remember that he was named that because of the fact that he had a talking crow.
Mm-hmm. And I like the talking crow.
Yeah. Huh.
It added a lot to the story that I hadn't gotten from the movie.
And it's never like the crow like gives large chunks of exposition or even has a lot to say, but it will tell Eric certain things sometimes. Mm-hmm. And then there's certain things like, you know, you shouldn't have looked.
Yeah,
a reoccurring thing about looking.
Mm-hmm.
I never would have thought of this when I read it originally, but like when I reread it for the show, for whatever reason, it reminded me of Deadpool and how Deadpool has like this, he has like two or three different voices going on in his head at once. Mm. And some of them are kind of meta. And it was almost like that. Like, and I know that's not necessarily what the idea was, but it almost felt like, another internal voice, mm-hmm. even though it was coming from the crow itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. There's, one part where he's basically, yeah, sitting there being mopey, thinking about Chili, and the entire time the crow basically has some analogy of him, like, sticking a knife in and twisting it mm-hmm. around. And I'm like, yeah, because that's, you know.
And a lot of the time the crow's like, don't, you know, don't do that to yourself.
Yeah.
Don't go in there. You know better than to go in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was surprised at how kind of experimental the whole thing felt.
Mm-hmm.
I was not really expecting that. I've read a little bit of newer crow stuff, the IDW stuff. The main one being I think it was a 3-issue miniseries that James O'Barr actually did. And that's kind of why I picked it up, because it was the first time in a long time that he's done a Crow book. Mm-hmm. I think it was Skinning the Wolves.
Yeah, I think I remember when that came out.
And that is like so like, I mean, the story is pretty wild, but it's so straightforward what you'd expect comic book storytelling, as opposed to this, which is like, there'll be, and part of it might have been the graphic novel, like, presentation, mm-hmm. but there'll be pages of artwork and song lyrics and stuff like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And
like a pinup.
Yeah. And then some, and then going from sequence to sequence, you'll have the art change, and then sometimes it'll just throw you into like, kind of, here's a murder scene, kind of like, you know, or an action mm-hmm. sequence. And sometimes it's almost, I don't want to say abstract, but it's almost like a little jarring, because mm-hmm. it's not, the flow is very strange between the panels and the mm-hmm. sequences. And then other times it's just pretty straightforward.
Right.
And like I said, the only other Crow thing of his that he wrote that I've read was that Skinning of the Wolves, which was pretty much very straightforward, what you'd expect, you know?
Mm.
I think it made the book more interesting. I was not expecting that kind of wild style
mm-hmm.
storytelling, I guess, is a way to put it.
Yeah.
When this Skinning the Wolves takes place in a concentration camp?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, and that I found that interesting, too, reading through this and thinking about that. Like, this one, clearly, and there's some backstory about his motivations for writing this. And mm-hmm. he had lost, I think, a girlfriend to a drunk driving accident or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then you've got Skinning the Wolves, which takes place in a concentration camp, which is clearly a heavy story. But I definitely felt the emotion behind this original Crow way more than anything in Skinning the Wolves.
Right.
It would obviously be between the him working through his issues in that book.
Mm-hmm.
There's obviously a real emotional connection with him in that book
mm-hmm.
That I think actually does come through quite a bit.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Whereas the story in the concentration camp, not that there's not no emotional impact, but just doesn't carry the same...
Yeah.
The same... spirit behind it.
Right.
Sure. It's probably not quite as personal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Just based on the distance of time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another thing. And maybe part of it is knowing that bit of his motivation for writing this before reading it, is it does feel like it carries impact. And if I didn't know that, I don't know if it would have necessarily felt that as impactful.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
But I thought it did.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I?
Yeah, please. Please.
One of the things that I liked about it is, like, and I had only ever seen the movie, but and I'm all about violence. The violence was insane.
Oh,
in,
yeah.
In this, like, way more hardcore than
the movie.
Than the movie. And even the bad guys, like, the bad guys were more bad in this than they were
mm-hmm.
in the movie. So all of it was, like, kind of stepped up a little bit. And I'm like, oh, well, I enjoy that.
Random indiscriminately just murdering people in the street.
Yeah.
And then the actual situation with Eric and Shelley
mm-hmm.
was a lot more brutal.
A lot more brutal and a lot more, like, completely twisted. Random.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, and that I did like, and again, this is comparing to the movie a little bit, but from, like, a screenwriter's point of view, I guess I could kind of see them being like, well, why is it just random? It needs to have some type of, there needs to be a connection or some reason. I like it better that it's just this random act of violence.
Yeah, me too.
They're broke down on the side of the road. These crazed junkies happen to drive by. Just random.
Right.
Just random. Because uh-huh. that's how that stuff happens in life.
And even the resolution is kind of random. And then when it's done, it's done. And that's not quite how the movie goes. I mean, not to draw comparisons quite yet, but
It was really hard not to while reading it, too.
Yeah.
While reading it, there was parts where I was like, oh, well, that's a lot like the movie. And then there's parts where I'm like thinking about the movie and I'm like, where did the screenwriter come up with this whole other chunk of story that is not has nothing to do with the book?
Yeah.
And I do want to talk about that a little bit more later on because, the whole end of the movie is very different.
But it had a lot of parts that I did like from the movie and I was happy to see, even though they weren't all in the same place.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
I don't know why, but that joke, the Jesus putting me up for the night joke, that one always got me.
That lands with you, huh?
And that was in the book. And then the thing, the, you know, mother is the name for
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that whole bit, I always kind of resonated with me too, and that was in the book and I was happy to see that.
Yeah, I think all the things that he wrote that wound up in the film hit pretty well in both mediums.
Even if it doesn't always work perfectly in the film, they pulled, I think, like I could see them reading the book and being like, oh, that's good. We can expand that in the movie. Because I thought the little, I mean, it's such a minor like subplot with the girl in the book. She only appears like twice, but that's really interesting. And it's so much more bleak in the book.
When there isn't a connection in the book either. It's like, I mean, the connection is similar. I mean, like they draw the connection into the movie, but then they expand on it. Like in the movie, they know Sarah and she has a name, I guess, in the movie. Whereas I don't think she has a name in the book.
No, she does have a name, but it's not Sarah, and her mother's name is not Darla. I think it's Sherry or something, and that's kind of
because it's real close to Shelley. Yeah,
and he says something about I knew a Shelley, blah blah blah. You know,
yeah.
So I was okay. The crow is much more self-destructive in the book.
Oh yeah,
I was really surprised by that. I was surprised by why did he inject himself with morphine? That really threw me.
Oh yeah,
like there's like two times where he just boom, and I was like, whoa, okay.
Yeah.
And that was part of my whole thing with the book. Because he didn't climb out of a grave.
Was he just there?
He just, showed up. And from, he was the one that went to the hospital, not her and whatever. And obviously he had woken up in the hospital because it showed him wake up in the hospital. So I'm like, I don't know how dead he actually was. And either way, this is definitely his body, you know, and not like some kind of crazy ghost body. So he's got to be feeling the pain that it feels and whatnot.
There's obviously some, like, kind of supernatural stuff going on in the book.
Yeah, that was a point where, and it's hard not to compare it to the movie, where I thought, I don't know if I like it better or worse that the movie explains it more.
The movie, really ramps up the mysticism.
Yeah.
Right. And they're like, well, here's the rules, basically.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Which they wind up using in, like, later movies. I mean, it's like, okay, the power comes from the bird itself. Mm-hmm. And that's never the case in the book that I could tell.
No. And even until the end when there was the big end fight with Top Dollar or whatever, I was questioning if he was dead at all. Really?
The crow?
Yeah. Like sure he had,
or Eric, I should say.
He'd gotten messed up and had some kind of brain injury. Maybe that's where the crow came from. It was some kind of hallucination or something. But other than that, he could have just been some guy who was crazy and working through all the pain he was feeling.
Well, that's an interesting point. And I hadn't really, while I was reading through it, I hadn't really considered that was the case, but I think it's there. You can totally read into it as that being the case. Mm-hmm. In later Crow books, it's very clear that they come back from the dead.
Well, no, even at the end of that one, it's something very supernatural like happens where it's obvious that, okay, well, that's not how it was going, even though that's how it kind of looked.
But he does, I mean, he cuts the crap out of himself, and then he does hit himself with, well, who was it? Fun Boy was the junkie?
Yeah.
Even says, like, you just took a 2 cc's morphine, whatever, blah, blah, blah. I don't know how that works out. Inferring that, like, what he just shot into himself should kill a person. Mm-hmm. But he did shoot a bunch of morphine into himself before, like, both big action scenes where he would have taken a lot of bullets. So I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
I loved the scene with the horse in the train.
Mm-hmm.
It was so weird.
Oh, yeah.
to me, that, I mean, that definitely seemed like that was his ride crossing from being, I mean, following that he's dead, you know, mm-hmm. crossing from being dead to the real world again.
Right.
But it was so, I was like, whoa, what's this? It's just such a change of scenery. And it, you know, the art is fantastic and the look on the horse's face. And it's one of those things where it's like, oh, it's kind of a nice moment. And then it goes into horror, like a terror thing.
Yeah.
I just like that scene. And then it ties, you don't even know at the time, but later in the book, it ties into the you shouldn't have looked
yeah.
thing. So
right.
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, the ghoulish looking train conductor is like, you know, ticket. And he just kind of shrugs like, what do I do?
Yeah. Yeah.
So that was interesting. And there's one page. There's not a lot of humor in this book. I think there's a bit of humor. Like, there's the jokes.
Mm-hmm.
There's, like, the dark humor. There's one page that has a bunch of humor out of nowhere, and I liked it. But thinking back on it, it's so weird, is when it's towards the end, and they give the cat to one of the officers,
uh-huh.
and the note that the crow writes
oh, yeah.
About the cat, you know, here's the cat, blah, 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 blah. Oh, yeah, and it's got fleas. And this. And, yeah. Yeah, there were a couple jokes on that. And then that page leads directly into, like, oh, yeah, here's this little girl that's living this horrible existence. So mm-hmm. even the humor is very short-lived.
When he strings, like, in the movie, he just, like, takes out Fun Boy. He just kind of mm-hmm. systematically takes him out pretty quickly. But Fun Boy, man, he kind of, like, strings him along. And he's like, okay, you're going to do this. And if you do, I'll make it quick and painless.
Yeah. I had a lot of thoughts about that whole thing because I'm like, he seems especially nice to Fun Boy. And I think it's, you know, he's kind of one of the most horrible ones, but he's like the only one that's like, I did that. I did it because I'm a bad person and I don't feel bad about it because I'm a horrible person because I'm a monster and I know that I am. And I think that's why he was so much nicer to him than the rest of them, because he accepts that he's so messed up.
Right. Like, he almost doesn't lay as much blame on Fun Boy as, well,
yeah.
T-Bird in particular.
Yeah.
He's actually, like, really polite or, like, kind to him. I mean, he's still responsible for the guy dying,
mm-hmm.
but he's, like, kind about it the whole way through, which is so strange.
Like, they have civil conversations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally loaded the whole time.
Yeah. And so that's the only thing I can come up with is that's why it is, because he's knows what he is.
Mm-hmm. I thought that was unusual.
But all of the bad guys are like, yeah, I did it. So what? You know, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
One scene Melanie and I were talking about that I think we both really enjoyed that was not in the movie at all, where he comes across, I don't remember who it's supposed to be, but a couple of guys. And they're attacking this, I think it was a guy with Down syndrome or something.
Mm-hmm.
And they're harassing him and they end up killing him. And the crow takes the one out and ends up taking the one guy's feet off.
Yeah. And mm-hmm. lets him bleed out. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And the line is great where the guy's like, those are my boots over there? You grab my boots, my feet are cold. And I loved it. I was like, wow.
I loved it too. It was great.
Yeah.
It's just,
that's pretty grim. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that was pretty early on, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was the second group of people he attacked or whatever, because the first was the one that got the gun and just randomly shot some lady across the street.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which is also kind of insane.
Yeah, for sure. And he takes out, I'm not sure if this is the case in the movie or not, he takes out several people that are not who he's after.
Yeah.
But they're still bad people.
Mm-hmm.
Like, at one point, he comes across a guy. I don't remember what the situation is, but the crow tells him, mm-hmm. you know, take him out. He's a chemical monster. Or is he chemical? He's chemical trash or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
the crow just, like, I think he cuts his throat or something. But I thought that was interesting that he just, like, it's not only he'll take out, you know, this guy's a bad guy, even though he's done nothing to me. I'm going to take him out. But it's also the crow was like, yeah. Take this guy out, telling him to kill this guy. So I thought that was kind of interesting.
Well, mm-hmm. like, and Gideon at the pawn shop, mm-hmm. he takes out Gideon no problem. Whereas in the movie, I think he lets him be kind of a like a messenger.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's kind of takes not that it plays out the same at all, but he kind of takes Funboy's place as a messenger, somebody who he lets go at least long enough to say, hey, go to your boss and be like, I'm coming. Overall, one thing I thought was interesting, but it makes 100% sense since this came out in 1989. I'm sure the guy had been working on it for quite a while before that. But I thought it was interesting because the original Crow just feels, the movie feels so 90s. And I identify it so 90s. But this book is so 80s.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The hair. Hair.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then some of the, like, and I know Melanie has fun with this. She'll dance around the apartment sometimes. But it's so odd, some of the scenes where it's him, like, you know, trying to deal with just the death of Shelley and the whole situation. It's he'll hit these poses where it's that totally 80s androgynous glamour sexy poses.
Oh yeah.
And it feels so weird at most of the time. It's kind of out of place. There's one page where it's almost like dancing poses.
It's ballet.
Like ballet, he's basically poses. Doing a ballet like routine almost. Like, yeah.
Expressing himself through dance. And it's so strange to me to go from just blowing dudes' heads off to these crazy.
And that's where, like, the Renaissance sculpture, like his research of the Renaissance sculptures and that kind of thing. I think that's where it played in. And so it was less jarring to me knowing that, but yeah, without knowing his background, it's like, what's going on here?
I think it's great fun that I can go up to the computer room and be like, in the doorway.
And she'll hit a pose, and then I'll be like, what are you doing? What are you crow dancing?
You about to kill Tom Tom? Tim. Skink. Skink's dead.
Skink's dead. That's Skink over there. That's okay. That's something else.
Yeah, and Skink wasn't in the book either.
Skink wasn't in the book, was he?
No.
And if he was,
it wasn't obvious. Mm-mm. That's for sure.
Oh God, Skink.
Foreign cars.
What else? There's. I think two other things I definitely want to say about the book before we move on past it. Unless you guys have more to talk about it, which is fine. I'm sure there are other things that also are this, but this is like. This book is like the definition. It's like the physical embodiment of 80s goth, like refined into like just pure. Like this is it's got the goth thing. Obviously in the style of the Crow, he's cutting himself. It's very moody. It's got the 80s sexy poses.
Mm-hmm.
It's even got I almost laughed when I come across to a couple of pages where. It actually has the song lyrics to the Cure music.
Oh, yeah.
And also Joy Division. I was like, this is goth 80s distilled into a physical book. It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was amused by it. I just had to say.
Yeah.
The Cure. As soon as
I just flipped through that page and it's like, first we're going to do one-armed pull-ups, then we're going to do one-armed push-ups, and then we're going to dance with the cat. that's his Rocky that's his Rocky 80s training montage right there. Push-ups, pull-ups, and cat dancing.
Cat dancing. Yes. The Crow cat dancing. So I mean, a little bit spoilers, I guess. It's a pretty old book though, so God, in a few years, it'll be 30 years old.
Don't say that.
Ooh, this book.
Oh, jeez.
You don't see him take out the last bad guy, who is kind of like his... I mean, he wants to take them all out, but he's got, like... This guy's obviously the leader. That's the guy that shot him in the head.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He's got, like, the head bad guy that he wants to end off with.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't see him take him out exactly, but you end on... And you don't see it in any other panel... But it ends on him holding a hammer and the guys in the background. And I was like, yes!
Mm-hmm. Well, and I thought, like, did I miss something? Because, it just ends on that shot. Mm-hmm. And you know he's going to drag this one out. Because he told Funboy, he's like, I promise you I'll make yours quick and painless, but not T-Bird.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And there's the whole car thing. And the like car chase kind of. And I was a little worried. I was like, oh, is it going to end like the movie? Is that where they got the car like burning up, flying into the lake thing? So I was a little worried. I was like, well, in a movie that seems spectacular, but it would have felt a little anticlimactic.
Mm-hmm.
But I love that they didn't show you the beating that was sure to come. He ended that sequence on the hammer, and I was like, wow. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's pretty awesome.
It was pretty awesome. Yeah.
That I think that is a lot more effective than actually watching him beat the crap out of this guy.
Right.
Yeah, I like that too. I was kind of jarred by it. It's jarring. It's like abrupt. But when I think about it, it's like that's more compelling.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's a better like cinematic image than almost. I mean, the movie has great images.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
The direction in the movie is awesome. It's part of what I think makes the first Crow movie work. But that hammer image is such a like cinematic thing to do. I was just blown away by it.
He's a little bit more diverse in his weaponry in the book. I mean, like, he uses the axe. He uses a hammer. He uses Tim Tim's knives.
Mm-hmm.
He uses whatever that loopy wire cutter stuff, or like razor wire or whatever, I'm assuming.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, overall, I enjoyed the book. At first, I was a little concerned when I started reading it. Not that I didn't think it was going to be good, but I was a little concerned I was going to have trouble getting through it. It's really not that long.
No.
Right. It looks thick, and I was like, uh-oh, Duncan the Wonder Dog. I waited too long.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's exactly it. It was like we were coming up on today, and I was like, oh. And the first little chunk, there was like, you know, there's some prose and stuff like that, and I was like, oh, this might take me longer than I expected. But then after a certain point, I breezed through the whole rest of it. It's actually a pretty easy read.
He spent 2 or 3 days being like, you should start reading The Crow. Well, now you need to start reading The Crow. Well, instead of doing that, why don't you read The Crow? And so I was like, fine. So I sat down, and I'm reading it, and then I came out, and I'm sitting here, and I'm talking to him, and I'm like, blah, 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 whatever, about The Crow. And he's like, yeah. He's like, how far are you into it? And I'm like, what are you talking about? I finished it. And he's like, oh, you already finished it? And I'm like,
blew through it in a sitting. I was like, what?
Yeah. Well, let's see. I talked to you guys about it last night, and I was like, oh, well, I only got a little bit left, and you said there's a lot at the end that's basically like poster pinup type stuff. Mm-hmm. And it was like, yeah, I could have stayed awake maybe 15 more minutes and been done. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize how close I was to the end.
Well, yeah, that's part of it. I was like, oh, there's quite a few pages left, and then the story ended. I was like, oh, there's quite a few pages left. And, you know, it's a lot of art and, you know, cool stuff. But, yeah, it's a lot of art and stuff. And I was like, okay, I didn't realize it was that short.
Yeah.
And speaking of that art that's in the back, it's interesting because there's a couple images in there. Like, I so completely identified the long coat as being black. But in some of the colored images in the back of the book, it was like a brown long coat, almost like a old-timey news reporter type jacket.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So the color images actually struck me as really odd.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it's just having read through all the black and white book, and then, like you said, assuming the coat was black and stuff like that, some of the color images, I don't know if it was just the colors they decided to choose or my preconceived notions. Yeah, it seemed really odd.
Another thing that, you know, like kind of dipping into the movie now, it's like when I looked at the casting of Brandon Lee, like being a fan of Brandon Lee and being a fan of Bruce Lee and even the movies that Brandon did previous to The Crow, I thought, wow, he's kind of an interesting choice for this guy that's basically a willowy like rock star. Mm-hmm. And I don't even think that plays into the book.
No,
In the movie, you know, like the fact that he is a, you know, he's in a band is kind of pivotal to it, and it shows up in the imagery, and they even have scenes where he's playing guitar and stuff, and they show like old playbill style posters of the band, and I thought, well, that's interesting because he's muscular, he's a martial artist, and yet looking back at that Renaissance style musculature of the Crow in the book, it's like, oh no, okay, I guess it does make sense.
Well, and he's got that slim muscularness.
Yeah,
the
what's lean muscle.
Lean, yes, thank you. Yeah, yeah.
That's the attractive muscle, just so you know.
Not the big, bulgy
yeah.
Hulk muscles?
Yeah, no, that's yeah. gross.
Arnold muscles.
Yeah. I think he was a good casting choice. Obviously, they made the movie in 94, so that hairstyle was out by then, and I'm really glad. I'm not a fan of that certain hairstyle that he has in the book.
Is that called Flock of Seagulls or whatever?
Very much, kind of, yeah. Yeah.
The big hair, but he was like, he looked like Pat Benatar a little bit.
One thing, rewatching the movie, and you can't see it in most shots. I don't actually think it's there in most shots, but there's a couple shots, especially like towards the end of the movie, where he's got the big gunfight scene with all the guys and he's walking along the table. The bullet casing is in his hair.
Yeah. Yeah. That's
true. I had never noticed that in the movie before. And I was like, wow, that's such a like a little detail they pulled from the book but didn't pay any attention to in the movie. But it's
And he's also got like a detached what is it? Like they say exactly what happens to him, but like a detached retina or something. Uh-huh. And so the one eye is pale.
Mm-hmm.
And it's even like that in the scene where he's killed. Like the first shot to the back of the head creates that scar across the top of the bridge of the nose, and then also detaches the eye, mm-hmm. and so you already get that that like one blind eye,
mm-hmm.
even before he becomes the crow itself, and that was not a thing they even tried to emulate in the movie.
I wonder if that whole thing with the pulling the eyes out of that chick. The brother and sister
that character's total invention, yeah.
I wonder if they used that eye as a, you know.
Oh, yeah, because there is an eye motif in the movie.
Yeah, but it's just not his eye.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Okay, so do you guys want to talk about the movie specifically now?
Yeah.
There's a lot of scenes that don't play exactly like the book, but pretty close. The pawn shop scene is really close. There's actually a few things in the movie that they expanded that make sense, because in the pawn shop scene in the book, he goes in, and when he sees the box of rings, he has this look on his face, and he's such a reaction that you get the idea that he's reacting to, wow, every one of these rings is a destroyed couple or a destroyed life and all this.
Sure.
But they don't, like, beyond that reaction, they don't really play on it in the book anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And in the movie, and I'm kind of glad they do, because I like that concept and I like how well it comes across in the book. In the movie, they kind of have to say it outright where he starts throwing the rings at the guy, and he says it, you know, every one of these is just, you know. So I like that they picked up on that and incorporated it, even though if it doesn't come across exactly the same way.
When they kind of did a fun thing where they almost co-opted like the Dead Zone from Stephen King, where it's like when he comes in contact with a piece that is part of his own history, he suddenly like absorbs those memories. It's like he's reabsorbing those memories, kind of thing. And so when he hits his ring, all of a sudden, boom, slapped with a flashback.
And that scene plays out pretty close to this, to how it is in the book.
Yeah.
Obviously, he doesn't. The pawn shop guy, I can't remember his name. I think you said it earlier.
Gideon.
He gets away in the movie. He becomes the messenger. But that one plays pretty close, even some of the dialogue. I don't understand. Like, I kind of do. From a screenwriter point of view, like what I was saying earlier, they're like, well, it can't just be random, and there needs to be a big climax. And I think the whole invention of the crow is where his power is, is simply like, and I kind of hate that they do it, although it works in the movie, there has to be something at stake. As it is, you've made an invincible character.
Right.
So they're like, well, let's take this cop character from the book, who's actually, they kind of amalgamated the two cop characters in the book into the one cop character in the movie. Let's take the little girl, expand on that, which totally makes sense. Like, I like that they did that, because that makes sense. That's like a human side of the comic that you can expand and get some material out of. But let's take them, let's put them in danger, let's make it so that the crow can be killed, because there's got to be something at stake. He can't just murder, it can't just be revenge and murder without any real risk. I kind of hate that they do that, but it made sense.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's the whole reason for the invention of this the rules with the crow and these two characters.
Mm-hmm.
But also, like, why these two characters?
Yeah.
The brother and sister and this, like, heavy mystic thing with them. Like, mm-hmm. I don't...
Yeah, and she's a total invention. And Top Dollar was, like, one of the first people to go.
Yeah.
And he's like nobody. He's just, like, a low-level drug dealer thug. And now he's, like, the crime boss of Detroit.
And this whole Devil's Night thing?
Uh-huh.
Like, it's really... I don't know. I really wonder where they got these, like... these ideas.
Yeah.
Did they pull it from later Crow series? Because I think there had been other Crow books by the time this one came out. I could be wrong. By the time the movie came out.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and it's written by different people and based on Jay Obar's work.
Mm-hmm.
Written by David Shrow and John Shirley. So I don't know. I don't know if I don't know to what degree he was involved in the original screenwriting.
I had asked that too about it, how he. Well, I don't know, but if he had signed off on it and how he felt about it, because.
Well, I remember, and this must be an interview I read years ago, probably in the 90s. But I remember reading something, and we're reaching many years back, so I could be totally wrong and off the mark here. But I remember reading that Jay Obar liked that they changed Eric to be a rocker. Mm-hmm. And this is something that like touches back on what you were saying, Jesse. I think he said in the book, in his mind, I thought he said that Eric was a construction guy, but I don't think they ever really touch on what he does.
They don't.
No, they don't. No, they barely even say what his name is.
Yeah.
I don't think Draven actually hits. You basically see him pulling a file at the police station, and there's like a D. I think you can see like Eric D, and I don't even know if I don't even think his full name shows up.
Yeah,
I could be wrong about that. I'd have to look more pointedly for that.
So maybe that's a thing where in J. O. Barr's mind, he was a construction worker or something.
Yeah,
but it's not really relevant. But he said he liked that they made him a rocker. And that he wish he would have thought of that because it would have totally made sense to do that. The book is so inspired by rock music.
Yeah.
That I'm putting words in his mouth, but I think he said he almost wishes he would have thought of that. So I know at least that part he approved of. Beyond that, I'm not sure. It'd be kind of interesting to dig up some interviews and see if we could find thoughts on, you know, it'd be interesting to know what he thought of it.
I would like to because... I guess I can't really say a whole lot of comic books that I know of, but I know there's been a lot of books that I really liked that were turned into movies, and then the writers are like, this is crap. How could they do this to my book?
Yeah, yeah.
And I wonder how... I always wonder now how people feel about it.
There is a Crow remake that is happening, and so I wonder if he's more involved in the new one, or if it's... if it's going to be a departure too, it sounded like the newer character what's her name? Mika or whatever. It sounds like she may be cast. So I wonder if it's a remake of the original movie or if it's a remake of the book or what we're going to get from a 2016 Crow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If it's, and who knows if it'll actually come out in 2016, but that's the IMDb date on that currently.
Mm-hmm. But, I mean, most of the changes between the one to the other make sense until they stop making sense. Like, even the changes that I'm not super fond of make sense because I'm like, I could see a screenwriter looking at this material and being like, well, we got to do this.
Yeah.
And then there's the changes where it's like, where did you pull this out of? Like, what is the deal?
Mm-hmm.
How do you guys feel about it as a adaptation of this graphic novel, the movie? Obviously, we know how accurate it is, but do you think it's a valid representation of it or interpretation?
I think they do a really good job of the things that they lift directly from the book. they did a really nice job of making those come alive. I think at the end, though, I feel like they tacked on a bit where he's a superhero.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's what it feels like, is like the end is like, okay, now let's make him a superhero. He's a hero and not just out for revenge. He's going to save his, you know, like cop's going to be his sidekick and save him a few times. And now Eric's going to save him because he owes him and because Sarah's life is on the line. And now he's a hero and not just out for vengeance.
And Melanie pointed out as we were watching this last time, what a cliche movie way for the bad guy to go. He falls off the building and lands on a thing that impales him.
Yeah,
in the rain.
Oh yeah, it could have been a Batman movie the way it ended.
I love the direction of the movie though.
Yeah,
and I know that director also did Dark City.
Mm-hmm. And that's a great one too. Yeah.
And you can definitely like visually tell there's like similarities, and I'm not sure what else he's done beyond that. But I do like the direction.
I like the movie, and like Jesse was saying, the things that are the same, I really like. I think they did a good job of them. But the stuff that they changed, some of it is ridiculous, and I don't think it was necessary.
Mm-hmm.
So, right. But I mean, I always liked the movie, so I can't really talk too much crap on it because I enjoyed it. And I want to say, it makes me, I mean, I was, you know, sad that Brendan Lee died anyway, but it makes me even more sad now. Because I wasn't like a super fan, but I had seen other Brandon Lee movies, and this was the first one where I'm like, wow, he's like an actor, like he's good, you know?
And then
it's done.
He portrays some he hits some nice emotional moments of like sadness and kind of hurt and stuff like that. He portrays it very well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's good for sure. And I think it's one of those things where, I mean, it's hard to say how his career would have gone past, much like Heath Ledger. Like, would the movie have skyrocketed him, or was part of it the fact that he was in this fantastic role and then died? But it does seem like this would have, like, I mean, it was a big movie.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Actually, I don't know how it did box office, but I know it was pretty big.
Like, still people dressed like the Crow.
Yeah.
For Halloween.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
I wonder, like, if it would have just, like, if he'd become a superstar at that point.
Mm-hmm.
When it became even, like, Sting from the WCW, Pro Wrestling, and basically took that shtick and went with it.
Mm-hmm.
So it became, like, iconic of that era, really.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it really did kind of. It defined definitely a certain niche, 90s niche. And it kind of makes sense because if you're taking from that source material, and like I said, it's so 80s goth, and then the Crow movie really kind of like exploded the mainstream 90s goth thing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Which lasted long into the 90s.
Dude.
For sure.
One of my main memories of The Crow is watching it repeatedly with people that were like, you know, all in black and like always like, I don't know, like I can't even.
He can't
see what I'm doing. So
that stereotype.
and like listening to Nine Inch Nails all day long, and which I, you know, did some too because Nine Inch Nails rock. But, you know,
wrong with wearing all black and listening to Nine Inch Nails all day long.
What, Nine Inch Nails?
You just picked my entire high school existence.
But you're one of those people that would sit there and that I would end up going and sitting and watching The Crow with, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, and I've seen that movie a million times.
Right.
But Nine Inch Nails is on the soundtrack, too.
The soundtrack is amazing. And there's
and the score. I mean, like, the music all around.
Mm-hmm. It has The Cure. I don't think it has the song that has the lyrics in the book, but they have The Cure. And I was like,
yeah.
That's pretty good, because they could have gone all early 90s at that point. There's a lot of early 90s stuff. It could have leaned exclusively towards the I guess early to mid 90s kind of industrial sound, which is a lot of it. But they also do dip back to, I mean, it was modern Cure stuff, but there's The Cure, there's also that still slightly 80s influence. Mm-hmm. So that's just kind of nice attention to what the book would, like, the most accurate version of the book in a movie would be.
Yeah.
Not that that movie is necessarily that, but nice mm-hmm. attention to detail that they would include that. And it's great. The mm-hmm. soundtrack's great. That's one of the first, I think, CDs I ever bought. And I've bought that soundtrack on both cassette and CD.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yeah. I bought it on both.
I'm sorry.
I bought it on both. Why you laugh?
No, it's funny.
It's fantastic.
It's fantastically funny.
And Jesse's right, though. The score is pretty awesome, too.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Even, like, the guitar bits that Eric plays.
Mm-hmm. And they feel a little bit out of place. They feel a little bit more 80s guitar mm-hmm. than the rest of the movie, but
well, and
still pretty cool.
The little bit of, what do they call it, Hangman's Joke or something was the name of his
band. Hangman's Joe or something.
Yeah.
Hangman Joe.
Even the little bit of that they play, it's a little softer, but it still has that kind of clean guitar, mm-hmm. slightly 80s sound.
Mm-hmm. Like a Cure cover band.
Yeah, exactly. So that was, you know, that's cool.
Can't rain all the time. I love that line, and that's not in the book, I don't think.
Mm-mm. Yeah. Mm-mm.
That was a construct of the movie.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like there were some good, they did some, there's some good stuff. Like I like some of the stuff they expanded quite a bit.
It's not a good day to be a bad guy.
That was not necessary.
Okay. Maybe it's not all gold.
So maybe one of the things that was so jarring about him shooting the heroin, or not the heroin, the morphine in the book, mm-hmm. I think, is the definitely anti-drug, to the point where it's anti-cigarette stance of the movie.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's right, because they have the scene with the cop smoking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then the scene where he delivers the one line to, in the movie, her name is Darla. In the book, it's something else. But the mom, in the movie, he grabs her arm and magically makes the morphine come out.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So not that the book's like pro morphine, like it shows a bunch of junkies being messed up and doing horrible things. Mm-hmm. At no point does the crow jamming needles into his chest that's all carved up make me think, I should try that.
Right.
But it's really strange. Like, I think the movie would have taken a really weird turn if they'd followed it that far, that mm-hmm. close.
Although, yeah. I did notice in the movie, they didn't have him inject any morphine, but there was a part where he was there and it showed him picking one up and looking at it with a look on his face, and then it cut scene. And I'm like, that's totally like would have been the scene in the book where he would have, like, taken it and used it, you know?
And they kept he cuts the crap out of himself in the book, and then towards the end wraps it up in electrical tape.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't cut the crap out of himself in the movie, but they kept the electrical tape stuff.
Yeah.
I like that.
He might have cut himself when he was swinging out the window.
He did. He cut his hands when he swung out the window and back in.
Well, we got to watch those heal right before him, so.
Yeah, and that kind of establishes his.
Yeah, the healing factor situation was different.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, because he didn't heal at all in the book, didn't he still just have like holes and weirdness?
I think so.
Yeah, I don't think he did heal. At least when he cut himself, that stuff stuck mm-hmm. around for.
He kept going. It didn't stop him, but I don't think that he ever healed.
Right. Which is another reason I thought he was normal. Oh, and my other one other thing that I didn't mention with him being like a person, he had gotten shot in the head, so I assumed he had like metal plates in his head, which is why he kept getting shot in the head and not getting hurt.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that would kind of make sense if they went through the surgeries and stuff.
Yeah. But we already discussed that part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the crow.
Mm-hmm. It's good. It's good.
Still
either
a
way.
Classic.
Oh yep. Yeah, for sure.
I still like the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I'll always like the movie. I think the book actually did manage to knock the movie down just a peg or two.
Uh huh.
In I my agree. Opinion. But I still enjoy the movie, and I enjoyed the book quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Me too. It's not something I want to like. Wallow in, though, because it'll make me all depressed.
Well, yeah. That is the world that the crow lives in.
Yeah.
That's why that one page with the cat and the cops and stuff, where it was like, that was like such a, like, out of nowhere, like, bit of humor.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I think really struck me as extra humorous because it's the movie's kind of bleak. The book is so bleak.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Go read The Crow.
But be careful.
Be careful. Jay O'Barr is going to be at Kansas City Comic Con.
Oh, nice.
Here coming up at the beginning of August, first part of August. So I'm going to see if I can see if I can get my copy signed from him.
That's awesome.
So I'll try to come up with my one good question and not be like, hey, do you know Ernie?
Do you know
Ernie Klein?
Yeah. I don't think he would. Maybe
no,
he does.
Not.
I don't
who
know.
Knows. Yeah, lots of poetry in the book, but probably not that kind.
I don't know this guy's life.
Right.
If anything, be like, so you like The Cure, huh?
Well, I was looking at the Wikipedia page for him, and I guess he did some artwork while he was in the military. He was stationed in Germany and illustrated combat manuals for the military.
Oh, wow.
While living in Berlin, 1981. That's when he started work on The Crow.
Wow. Really?
Yeah.
Well, no wonder it feels like the 80s. It's like the entire decade collapsed into one book.
And yeah. He was in Germany, which is freaking depressing.
And, you know, okay, so it does feel like the 80s because his hair and a little bit the style, and then you've got some song lyrics from 80s bands. But I don't think, for the most part, the majority of it doesn't feel that dated.
Mm-hmm.
The bad guys don't necessarily look 80s. They just look like bad guys.
Mm-hmm. There were a couple guys that had, like, headbands, and I was like, oh, nobody wears headbands. Yeah. Like, Kung Fury wears a headband. And that's supposed to be dated.
Yeah. But the story, I don't think felt... I mean, it definitely felt like an 80s book, but
mm-hmm.
I don't think it's, like... ruins. I don't think it ruins it for a modern reader.
No.
Like, sometimes things are so dated where it's hard to get past it. I did, however, want to listen to, one, The Crow soundtrack, and two, all the 80s goth rock CDs I had. I just wanted to listen to
it. Did you want to dust off your black long coat? Like, it's the middle of summer, but I'm feeling oddly cold.
People are like, what are you doing? Reading The Crow? What are you doing?
I'm pondering an existential quandary.
Exactly.
Head like a hole.
Black as your soul. Anyway, what would you guys like to talk about now? Because we've run through our material.
It's because we talked about so much last time.
Have you guys seen any movies since the last recording? Like, did you go to Terminator or...
Mm-mm.
I can't even think. Oh, Ant-Man?
No.
Nope.
No, yeah, we haven't... I don't even think I've hardly watched anything. We watched The Crow. Never mind. We've been watching Doctor Who.
Yeah.
We haven't been watching a lot of movies because we hit Doctor Who pretty hard.
And you put Fallout on my computer.
Oh, yeah, and we started playing Fallout
3. Oh, yeah. What, you getting ready for 4?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're playing 3.
I'd never played any of them, actually. And, you know, that coverage of Fallout 4, like, what was it, E3 coverage or whatever, intrigued me. Like, I always thought it looked cool. I liked the world. Right. Part of what kind of... I'm not a fan of first-person shooters. Mm-hmm. I don't know what the difference is between... first person and third. I mean, I know what the difference between first person and third person is, but I like a third person view. I like to see my character. I feel like I have a better...
kind of a top down kind of situation.
Well, I feel like I have a better grasp when I can see my character, like, versus like where I'm at in the environment and stuff like that.
Sure.
And first person view, you know, you're supposed to see through the character's eyes. It's supposed to be more immersive, but like...
Do you play it third person?
No, actually, I play it first person.
Okay. I have never played it third person, but I think I should, because... things attack me from behind all the time, and it'd be better if I could see them attacking me and know which direction to turn to try and kill them.
Well, I didn't realize you could play it as either first person or third person.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
Coincidentally, I only ever play it in first person. But I don't... part of my problem with a lot of first person shooters, like particularly the army ones... I cannot see where the enemies are.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they blend into the background all the time. And Fallout 3 doesn't have a very large color palette. It's got that end of the world, that post-apocalyptic desert gray brown tone.
It's either brown or it's gray, and that's it.
But yeah. I can still usually see them coming, mm-hmm. or I just spam the V button that makes that VAT system, and uh-huh. that highlights any enemies that are close enough for you to shoot anyway.
Right.
So I don't have that kind of problem. It's a pretty awesome game.
Yeah, I like it. It was really hard for me in the beginning.
Till you found some cheat codes.
Yeah. Well, I was getting crazy mobbed. Like, I get attacked by a pack of dogs. A pack. Not like a dog. Like a pack of dogs. Mm-hmm. And then the scorpions would come up and kill me from behind.
And, you know, with this game, it seems like I'm not that super interested into the shooter aspect of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, there should be a challenge, sure. But it's very much an RPG. I mean, it's a Bethesda game, and they do the Skyrim games, which is like the obvious fantasy RPG. So it's similar to that, except it's, you know.
Yeah, you get to run around and do whatever you want.
In my opinion, a much cooler setting.
Yeah.
So playing through the story, like, and all the side quests and stuff like that is the major part of the appeal, I think. So mm-hmm. I don't have a problem with you cheating. Eventually, if I get killed enough, I'm going to cheat.
I was getting killed, seriously, like every time I left the town. I would go out to try and get something done and die. Every time.
Closest thing I've got to that is the Borderlands series.
Mm, mm-hmm.
I'm really into the style of that, even though it's basically very classic first-person shooter, but it's got all the really bizarre humor and bizarre guns. Like, you can have a shotgun that basically shoots fire or acid.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll get stuck at a point where it's like, this bad guy seems nigh unkillable, and then I'll just do a quick search on YouTube, and someone will have figured out the easiest, most insanely, you know, like exploitive way to finish it. It's like, oh, just find this little corner, hide in there and shoot. Like, yeah. Oh, so I mean, not like a cheat, but it's still a cheat. It's like an exploit.
Yeah. Wait till he's this way. Run up behind him, hamstring him, and then you can take your time.
Yeah. It was like the final bad guy of the second game is like, just shoot at him from over the fence.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that is like it's gaming the system, mm-hmm. but it works.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you know. If something's so hard that you're not enjoying it, then why do it? And in something like that or Fallout, there's a lot of other stuff beyond just the challenge to enjoy. So, you know, might as well.
Yeah.
Right.
The Borderlands games, I've only played, I think, the second one for a little bit.
Second one's pretty good, yeah.
They're very interesting. I do like the style. I like the look of it. I like the art style. And apparently they come at it from an angle of, like, we're going to take the first-person shooter tropes and the video game tropes and turn it on its head or play on it. Or like,
oh, yeah, it's and very turn it up to 11.
Yeah.
I mean, like, it they take all of them, too. Like, and they'll have different DLCs and expansions that are, like, they'll be specific to that one thing. Like, like in the first game, they had the zombie one. And then they had the one that was more of a, you're going to be in a car the whole time. And, in the latest game, they had more of a Thunderdome one where basically, it's like, what if the Thunderdome were run by Macho Man Randy Savage? So it's like he yells the whole time, and he's like basically putting on these huge production, style grudge matches. And that's the game is that you've got to climb the ladder and become the top dog in what would be like a Thunderdome.
Yeah, I really like, I've heard some of the developers and stuff on various podcasts. I listen to more video game podcasts than I play actual video games.
Oh yeah, I believe that, yeah.
So I've heard, because I'm fascinated, even if I don't get into a lot of games, there's really only select games that I get into, I'm still fascinated by video games in general.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
So I'll listen to those, and I've heard some of the developers and whoever else hypes those Borderlands games. And yeah, I definitely like the attitude at which they come at those games.
Yeah. Speaking of, I was sending you messages, and you had said that there's actually a a community game that was created.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, because you said you were talking with your peeps.
Yeah.
About, what was it, about games that didn't exist, or like fake games that eventually somebody made real?
Yeah, they existed in a movie or a book or whatever, like say this Last Starfighter.
Mm-hmm.
That game didn't actually exist, but based on what we see in the movie, someone else created it, and it's super complicated, just like in the movie, where it's, you know, like in the movie, the plot is, if you're good at this game, it's basically a flight simulator and we're training you.
Yeah, and that got me thinking about, I was trying to think of other ones, and I'm incorrectly give you information about the Fallout, or not Fallout, Far Cry 3 Blood Dragon. I thought that it started as just a April Fool's joke that people were into, so they made it real. Turns out it was real, but they were trying to troll people anyway. So yeah, in Community, I think season 5, there's an episode that takes place almost entirely in this retro-style game. Pierce's... Maybe it wasn't season 5 if Pierce was in it. It might have been season 3. It doesn't matter. Pierce, the Chevy Chase character, his dad had died in an earlier episode. Killed kind of by one of the other characters. Anyway. That show just has great things where one of the other characters is kind of responsible for his dad dying, and then towards the end of the season, they'll be like, do you remember when Jeff killed that guy? You know, they just like throw little things out like that. But it's supposed to be a game that was developed in the 80s, and it was kind of a trial, like if Pierce or whoever can beat this game, because Pierce had wanted to invest in video games, then he gets the fortune, the family fortune or whatever. But anyway, it's just a wild retro-style game, and most of the episode is in the game. It's kind of got... I mean, it's not truly 8-bit type graphics. A little better than that, but it's got that old-school side-scrolling thing. Mm-hmm. And, so the whole episode is pretty much in this video game. And I don't remember. Just browsing through, I think, Reddit, and I found a subreddit of people that have created the actual game. They made a, like, you know, it's a fan effort.
Right.
And it's one of those things that's continually being developed, and they're adding things, because in the TV show, like, there's no old school game as advanced as the game they show in the show.
Yeah, like, sure. Going to some village and then meeting somebody and getting married and having
virtual babies and building a big palace and all this.
Right.
Well, they're trying, like, they kind of are trying to make that game.
Yeah.
And I was as a community fan, I was fascinated. I was like, what? I can play that game? People are making that game? And there's a lot of fan service, obviously. It's made by fans. Like, you can select characters, but you can also, there's like, seem like dozens of costumes for each character that are all references to different episodes. But I was fascinated by this community of, I think it said they've had over 50 people program different parts of the game, and it's literally whoever comes along, like, you know how to program, or can you contribute music or graphics? Mm-hmm. And it's just this awesome community effort.
Oh, boy.
So I was really fascinated by that, but it's called something about Hawkthorn. Oh, I really should know. I'm going to have my community card revoked.
Yep. I don't know what it is, so.
But yeah, it's Journey to Hawkthorn, or Journey Through Hawkthorn or something is what it's called.
Mm-hmm.
I'll have a link. Since we're talking about it, I'll have a link in the show notes. But yeah, I thought that was awesome.
So when are they going to come up with the Wild West VHS game?
Oh, God. Nobody wants that. Nobody wants that. The guy who is in that video, he guest stars in that episode, is Vince. I'm so terrible at remembering these things. But it's the guy who makes Breaking Bad. The show creator for Breaking Bad is the Wild West guy.
Oh, is he?
If I'm wrong, I'm going to edit this whole part out. But I'm pretty sure it is. Yeah.
It's amazing enough that you just know this. I mean, even if you don't remember everybody's name, that you know all this little obscure information anyway.
The Breaking Bad showrunner on Community. Like, I have to know that. That's amazing. he's also had the guy, the Arrested Development showrunner on several episodes. He's the the Coogler or whatever, that older guy that shows up once in a while. They had that like 80s movie, like, oh, it's the Coogler.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Like that parody thing. Mm-hmm. He's the Arrested Development showrunner. Like, it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Incestuous television Hollywood.
Yeah.
God, I wish I'd have thought about us talking about this, because I like the idea of like searching into games that started off as a fake property and somebody made real.
Because mm-hmm.
I'm sure there's bunches.
Well, my friend was telling me that somebody made the game that is actually in Tron. Like, there's a Tron game, but the game that is in Tron was different, but somebody else actually created it.
That's cool.
Yeah, that's awesome. So. That is, like, kind of fundamentally, like, you can tell, that's a big misstep. If you are an official game company and you've been licensed to make a Tron video game, not to, even as just, like, a bonus, include the games that they play in Tron as, like, mini games.
Yeah.
Right.
How do you miss that? How do you
that's
not
like,
do that?
That's like making a Wreck-It Ralph video game and not having Fix-It Felix in there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Crazy. So they're going to make a Minecraft movie?
They are?
And, oh. Yeah.
Well, there's a story-based game coming out, too.
By Telltale Games, who did the Walking Dead games. And so that's...
And the Fable one.
The Fable game.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And Tales from Borderlands, which is the one Borderlands game I haven't played.
And we've only played a bit of the Walking Dead Season 1 game.
Mm-hmm.
And a bit of the Fable game, Wolf Among Us.
Mm-hmm.
But from our experience and from the reviews I've heard, like, all those games are supposed to be killer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I like the start of it. I realized it was going to be really expansive, and so I didn't get any much further. And I've got both seasons of the Walking Dead game. I just haven't played it yet.
Mm-hmm.
But they have they have like a poker game, and I'm not generally a poker fan.
Oh, I think you mentioned this. Yeah,
I think so too. Yeah, Telltale's Poker Night, or yeah, something to that. Poker Night and Poker Night 2, and one of them has like Brock Sampson.
That's from and Ash and stuff.
Yeah, yeah. The second one has Brock Sampson, Ash, Claptrap from the Borderlands game, and then I think it's Sam from Sam and Max. And then the first game has got different ones, like it was either Gabe or Tycho from Penny Arcade, Max from Sam and Max, and then, oh, who else? A couple other characters that were interesting. Oh, the Heavy from Team Fortress. So all these little, like, game and pop culture references.
Mm-hmm.
And they're all just sitting down playing Texas Hold'em.
That's so bizarre.
I don't normally like Texas Hold'em, but when I can be playing the game with those characters, it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, that's so weird. Oh, well, here's something I don't think we've talked about at all. Ash versus the Army of Darkness?
Actually, I have not seen that. Ash versus the Evil Dead or whatever.
Yeah, the Starz television show. It's the Evil Dead TV show.
Really?
With Bruce Campbell.
The one trailer I hadn't watched from San Diego Comic-Con.
I actually have not watched the trailer either. I really should. Oh. But, yeah.
I didn't even know it existed.
Yeah.
Until you just mentioned it
just now. Oh. Mind blown?
Yeah, I want to see it.
And Sam Raimi's involved. Bruce Campbell is Ash.
Yeah, Bruce. Yeah, he is the main character.
That's great.
He has to be.
Yeah. So I'm really curious. I'm excited.
Mm-hmm.
I want it to be good. It's one of those things where I'm super excited, but I'm also like kind of apprehensive, just because you don't know what it's going to be exactly.
Yeah.
I bet it'll be either way. It'll be fun.
Mm-hmm.
If they're following.
So mentioning San Diego Comic-Con, like, so many trailers came out, and we haven't talked about any of them. What were your favorites?
Well, like I had mentioned on Twitter, that the Batman v Superman, Dawn of Justice, that trailer actually kind of got me excited for the movie. There are still things in the trailer that I'm kind of like, I don't know about that.
Mm-hmm.
But it did get me excited, because you get to see more.
Yeah.
More Batman, more Superman and Batman looking mad at each other.
Yeah.
There's definitely some cool looking things. What's his name? The director.
Zack Snyder.
He's such a visual director, and that's awesome. But there's always, like, even though I liked Man of Steel, I'm one of those, there's always something that's missing in his movies.
Mm-hmm.
It's like there's no soul to any of them. Like, they look great, there's no soul. Even though I like several of his movies, I don't think I'm that big of a fan of his, so I'm kind of worried just because...
This is Sparta, how he does things.
Yeah, like, I'm just kind of worried. Like, even 300. 300 is a great-looking movie.
Yeah.
The first time I saw it, like, there was just something that I felt missing about it. I was like, there's just something that's not there.
Mm-hmm.
It's a soul.
Same thing with, the Watchmen movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's good, but for whatever reason, it doesn't feel like it's as good as it should be.
Yeah. Totally.
Well, I think...
I love that book.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And...
I understand the changes. I mean, like, I understand why he did things the way he did, and it should just be awesome, but I'm like, I don't know about it.
No, that's another... That's another one of those... I actually kind of like 300 a little bit more, maybe, but...
Oh, I like 300, but... I'm sorry, go ahead.
It's one of those movies that I watched it once, and I'm like, It's all right, and I'm probably, maybe I'll watch it again someday, but I might not. It might just be that one time, and that's it, and I never watch it again, and that should be a movie that I want to watch over and over.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Watchmen, I mean, Tom.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, I mean, one of his first big movies was the Dawn of the Dead remake. It's good.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
But
I have seen that one a bunch, but that's because it's on TV all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But I like the beginning. The beginning is good.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give him that. That's a pretty good chunk of stuff right there. But the rest of it,
I just have a hard time like pinpointing what it is. But almost all of his movies, it's just kind of cold. He has like a mechanical feel to it.
Yeah,
I even own them, and then I just don't ever watch them. Like I own 300. I don't really watch it. Dawn of the Dead, same thing. I own it. I watched it when I bought it, but I can't say that I've popped it in since then. Same thing with the Watchmen. I own it. But I don't really find the occasion to pop it in.
Like, all of his movies look amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I haven't watched Sucker Punch, but I've heard so many bad things about that.
Yeah, that one you could skip.
Yeah. Yeah.
Again, it looks amazing, but that's all that one has.
But did he write that one?
I don't know.
Anyway.
I think that one was a property, too. I think it...
Oh, really? Okay.
It was based on something. I could be wrong about that, but... Feels like that one was based on something, and yet again, looks good.
Hmm.
Kind of missed its mark. I don't know.
But that was kind of a big sidetrack, I guess. But the Batman v Superman trailer kind of got me excited. I do. I'm very curious. There's a lot of things going into it that I'm like, Ben Affleck.
Yeah.
There's a couple shots that have me intrigued, but I think they look awful. It's when Batman's in, like, some... I don't know if he's in the Middle East, but he's in some desert. And he has this special desert bat suit on.
Oh, yeah.
On the one hand, I'm like, that looks really goofy. But on the other hand, I'm like, Batman would so wear that in the comics. He would totally wear something like that. And in the comics, it would work. Because it's a comic book. And, like, you could just get away with things.
Mm-hmm.
It made me a little worried, but I'm very intrigued. I don't know where they're coming at this angle with the Superman, like the army guys with the Superman logo on their sleeves.
Mm-hmm.
I'm concerned about what that is.
Yeah.
But I'm kind of excited. What did you guys think of... Oh, this is one that I don't think they've released like the Red Band trailer yet. Melanie really needs to see the Deadpool trailer. Have you seen that one yet, Jesse?
I've seen the leaked version. Yeah,
me too. I think Melanie is going to love it.
I think I'm going to love it too.
It's looking pretty perfect.
It's and the one that leaked, which you probably can't find now, it's a Red Band trailer. So filthy. They say some of the worst things.
Yeah.
But you know that like leaked test footage a while ago that looked like it was all CG. I mean, it looked good, but it was the action scene with the car and
yeah.
A lot of that is in the trailer.
Okay. Yeah,
which I thought was interesting.
A lot of that.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter. I love Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah, you do. And you're going to like it. And it seems like I have not read a lot of Deadpool. I've seen plenty of Deadpool to get the feel of who he is.
Yeah.
So it seems pretty accurate. A lot of the fans seem pretty happy with what they're seeing so far.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to be really happy if it's good, too, because, like I said, I love Ryan Reynolds, and he loves Deadpool, and he wants to do a good Deadpool. He wants to be a good superhero, period.
Yeah.
Right.
And he hasn't been yet, and he wants to be, and I want him to be. For him.
And that's one thing. When you see, like, I don't hate Ryan Reynolds. I think he's okay, but he's just always Ryan Reynolds.
He's not always Ryan Reynolds.
He's almost always Ryan Reynolds.
There was a few movies where I was like, oh, you know, that's not the typical Ryan Reynolds role. There was one, what was it? He was like a cop or something, and I'm like, oh, he's not witty banter guy.
Well, and there's the one, I can't remember what it's called, where he's, like, buried in a coffin the whole movie. In the Middle East, he gets kidnapped and they bury him. And
that's one I didn't watch.
It was depressing, actually.
Yeah.
But so he's not like cracking jokes there because he's gonna die. But he does. I do like him though, and he you can tell he makes conscious choices to pick roles that aren't just Ryan Reynolds.
Right.
But all the big movies are just Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah.
But that being said, I like that he's fought so hard for this character.
Mm-hmm.
He fought for the character. He fought for the movie to be rated R. He obviously is into it. So you always appreciate when they can cast somebody who is clearly a fan. And it doesn't matter if they cast somebody who's like, I've never read any of it. But as a comic book reader, it's really disappointing.
And I like it especially because he was the other Deadpool that everyone was disappointed with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he gets to kind of set things right. That's,
right, yeah.
That's kind of nice. Is it Smoke? Maybe Smoke and Aces was the one I'm thinking of, where he didn't play what I thought was his typical role.
Yeah, I think you're probably right.
Yeah, I think I enjoyed that movie.
Yeah.
It wasn't a big...
That movie had one of my favorite Ben Affleck roles because he was...
Because he died in like the first 30 seconds.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's one of the few movies they actually killed him off in. He doesn't get killed off in a lot of his movies.
I really liked him in Paper Man, which was a really weird movie. And he plays like, oh, what's his name? Was it Jeff Bridges? Not Jeff Bridges. Jeff Daniels is the main character. And Ryan Reynolds is like this imaginary friend character that Jeff Daniels' character had. When he was young, called Captain Excellent. And so he's just like this hallucination that wears a superhero outfit in the movie. And I was like, that's kind of perfect for Ryan Reynolds.
I don't think I've ever seen that.
You know who should hang out? Ryan Reynolds and Nathan Fillion. I think they would...
Oh, yeah, that would be a fun superhero
great friends.
Team.
You know, yeah. It's funny you mentioned that because when he was talking about his character, Ryan Reynolds' character, it made me think of Nathan Fillion's character in Super, where he's like the imaginary, well, I think he's from a show or something, but he's like the imaginary Christian superhero that Dwight, I don't remember his real name, but Dwight from The Office, like hallucinates him up sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they seem like very similar, goofy, fun guys.
And yeah, they kind of seem like they like to circle the same like area of movies and shows, like the same genres.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And they're both cute.
Handsome guys.
Yep.
Gooey, dreamy.
Gooey, dreamy guys. So what did you guys think of the Suicide Squad trailer?
Mm-hmm. I am more interested than I was. I went from not caring at all to caring a little bit.
It feels like the 90s, which which is like something people joked about before the trailer even come out. They're like, "Oh, it looks so extreme," you know, all the like the character designs and stuff. And then the trailer come out, and I'm like, "Some of this rings of The Crow." But worse yet, it rings of The Crow sequels.
Oh, yeah. Did you ever see the Nerdist parody trailer?
Yes.
Yeah. That was kind of perfect.
Wait, was it extreme or was it epic? What were they saying in there? Sick. Yeah.
Like, I was out, it couldn't have been me. I was out getting this. And it's like a Calvin peeing on a bat symbol kind of thing. Uh-huh. It was like, and Batman's like, sick.
I think Jared Leto could probably do an okay Joker, but I'm still just really worried about it.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it doesn't help that they're not showing us anything about him. Mm-hmm. Like, and they probably shouldn't, but I don't know. It's not endearing me to the project. It's not giving me any sense of hope, really. Because I don't have anything that I can actually compare it to. And I shouldn't compare it, but that's going to happen anyways.
Yeah.
And I don't like the tone of the trailer where it's got that, like, oh, music going on. And is it Harley Quinn in that cage, right?
I think so.
Where she's doing that, like, ribbon hanging dance and the light and all that. And
yeah,
like,
the almost Barnum and Bailey kind of acrobatic thing.
Yeah, with the music. I'm like, what kind of intro for Harley Quinn is this? Like, it just seemed so weird.
Mm-hmm.
There were some cool images, though. There's images where it's like, I don't know if it's them or if it's somebody's dressed up in like different characters with guns, like robbing places or something. There's like a big panda, somebody in a big panda suit with a gun, and somebody's got like a Batman, obviously like mask, like fake Batman mask.
Right.
There's some cool imagery. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'll watch it because I'm very curious, but I'm not super excited for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that makes me sad because I like Harley Quinn. Mm-hmm. I don't necessarily like the comic all that. I mean, it's okay, but it's a little too cheesy poof for me. But I like the dynamic with her and Joker.
Yeah, well, you like the character.
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily what they always do in the comics with her, but...
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, and I'm kind of worried about Deadshot.
Yeah.
Because, like, Deadshot is genuinely... He starts out as a genuinely creepoid character. Like, he's a bad guy.
Mm-hmm.
He's not a nice guy. And Will Smith is maybe the least convincing guy I can think of to play a bad guy like that.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll pick different roles, but I almost don't see him as being like, yeah, I'll play this totally irredeemable character. Even Hancock was like a despicable superhero, but eventually there's that character arc.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He's redeemed, yeah.
So, yeah, I don't see him willingly being like, yeah, I'll be a total slime ball, and that's the whole character, and he's too clean.
And I guess Deadshot comes around, and he's not the worst bad guy ever now, but like, this is our first chance to see him in a movie, and he's supposed to be a bad guy in Suicide Squad, and he just feels like, well, I guess we're gonna save the world a la Independence Day.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Oh, I know. His clips were on the nose trailer clips. Like, what, some kind of Suicide Squad?
Oh, come on. Yeah, he got the worst clips in the trailer, really.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like, well, I guess we'll save the world then.
Yeah. But, I don't know, maybe the movie will be amazing.
Maybe.
I'm a DC reader. I don't want to go and be thrilled by Marvel movies all the time. I want to see some good DC movies.
Yeah.
Right. And they're not doing enough. Like, I'm excited for Batman vs. Superman because I love me some Batman. But that's it.
Right.
It's like based solely on the fact that I want to see an awesome Batman movie.
Right.
It's not based on what they're showing me.
Yeah. It's not going to be an awesome Batman movie. It's got Ben Affleck in it.
I know. They've got a lot of strikes.
I'm sorry I'm so down on him, but Jesus. Come on.
I don't hate Ben Affleck, but I kind of hate Ben Affleck.
I do.
I think as he's gotten older, I
feel for Ben Affleck the same amount of love I feel for Mark Wahlberg. They're equal in my book. Yeah.
I'm curious. I think Ben Affleck's a fine director.
Oh, yeah.
Which is really amazing. Like, I wouldn't have guessed.
Mm-hmm.
And
to Ben Affleck's credit, To the best of my knowledge, he has never played opposite a teddy bear.
That's true.
He's got that over Mark Wahlberg, at least.
That's true.
That.
Or an Optimus Prime.
Yeah. Right. I think we got a Transformer. I used to like Mark Wahlberg, and I don't dislike him. I like him.
I like him in, like, The Departed. He's had some really good roles. But he's also had some roles where, like, dude, you're just getting paid.
Mm-hmm.
Not even trying now.
Did either of you guys ever... I mean, maybe... I don't know how familiar you guys are with the Max Payne video games at all.
Only slightly.
I saw the movie.
Oh, God. Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, it wasn't a great movie at all.
It was a terrible movie. And if you've played the video games... Okay, so this a little bit ties into The Crow. Back on track. What is their insistence, movie studios that is, if they take from a comic book or a video game series, and that comic book or video game series has nothing to do with supernatural things happening, why do they insist on injecting supernatural things? They're like, what? Oh, it's based on a video game? Oh, we should probably have some crazy magical stuff.
Like, yeah.
Max Payne has nothing, like, there's some awesome, creepy, like, there's some whacked out bad guys that have obsessions with angels. There's no angels. There's no supernatural nothing. Max Payne, the first two Max Payne games were based on gritty, film noir, over-the-top, like, hard-boiled detective movies.
Uh-huh.
That's what the games are based on.
Right.
And then they added bullet time because The Matrix. And it works. So then they make this movie with freaking Mark Wahlberg, and there's angels and, like, weird stuff happening. Like, why? Why would you do this?
Yeah.
It's based on hard-boiled film noir detective movies.
Mm.
Should be pretty, like, cut and dry what you're doing if you're actually trying to make this into a movie.
Yeah.
You take that route. You make some crazy slow-mo action scenes because that still works. You got a movie.
Well, and then you take, and we've talked about this on the show before, but you take Constantine, then, which is supposed to be supernatural, and somehow you're going to mess that up.
I've never seen it, but I've heard people complain a lot about the Jonah Hex movie.
Oh, yeah.
Well, Jonah Hex is a DC character, and yeah, I don't know if All-Star Western is still going, but even in the New 52, they had a Jonah Hex All-Star Western series. It's Western.
Yeah.
Jonah Hex is a cool character. He's, like, kind of a bounty hunter type with, like, a jacked up face. He's all scarred up.
Mm-hmm.
But otherwise, he's just a cowboy. You know? And from the little bits of that I've read, a lot of times it's like the gritty Western, which is super cool. You know, I'm not a big Western fan, but you got, like, that gritty Western with the anti-hero.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool. And I have not seen the movie, but they cast Josh Brolin as Jonah Hex. That's almost perfect. That guy's great in Western type stuff. And then apparently added all this, like, science fiction and magical stuff to it. Just make a Western. That's what the property is. Just because it's from a comic book doesn't mean you have to inject this stuff.
I don't know what they're thinking, babe.
I hate it. Well, they don't understand the medium. They're just like, hey, here's a property. Here's a name we can do something with.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't they do the same thing with The Spirit, where they took The Spirit and they basically slapped Sin City style stuff on it?
Yeah.
It's like, okay, we just made Sin City out of The Spirit, which is the Eisner property.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. I did see The Spirit. I was not impressed.
I didn't see it.
It was not good.
I think it's that executives all have, like, pretty model blonde girls that they're trying to impress. And then they're like, I think we should put in some angels. And then that's what they do. And that's how it happens.
What's this about angels?
Yeah, that's how it all goes down.
It's like, no, there were no actual angels. But that kind of makes me think of the Crow thing, where it's like, so, okay, you want to, like, explain why he's back from the dead. You can push some supernatural stuff, but, like, why push the whole mystic thing as far as they do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's really kind of weird.
When it gets even worse in the later movies, mm-hmm. where they, like, try to steal the Crow's power entirely and give it to somebody else and yada, yada, yada. What happened in the first movie? What can we do and push it even more? Ugh, don't.
They're improving on... Well, part of the issue, I've heard a lot of, you know, amongst all the podcasts I listen to, I also listen to a lot of comic book podcasts, and I've heard a lot of interviews with comic book writers that have been in the industry for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I won't say names because I'll probably mess it up and misquote people, but... And so I've heard a lot of stories about movie companies will be like, we want to turn this character into a movie.
Mm-hmm.
You wrote this character. Oh, no, we're not going to hire you to write the movie. We got this other guy, but we have some questions. And they call him up and ask him questions. And then the people would be like, well, no, I mean, you're missing the point, blah, blah, blah. And apparently, and this is very common, the movie studio people will be like, listen, we just have some questions for you. You're lucky to even be talking to us.
Right.
It's like, no, you're talking to the person who created the property or created the storyline you're going to rip off to make your movie.
Mm. Yeah, all of their fans are going to come to this movie because they've been waiting to see it.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to take the attitude of, like, you're even lucky to just be talking to us.
Right.
I wish I could dig up what... There's a great story that's, like, infuriating.
Yeah.
No. What's the word?
Infuriating.
There's, like, two words.
Furor. You just took a furor.
Infuriating. Infuriating.
Turns Randy to Hitler.
yeah. Angry Hitler. Not just regular Hitler.
Two words.
Angry Hitler.
There's two words I can't say, and for some reason, I try to say them all the time. Particularly, sometimes I can say it. Sometimes it's the worst.
Yeah.
There's a lot of times that if you listen to like the last several episodes, you'll hear it every time. I'll say specifically because I can feel it. I can feel my tongue twisting in on itself.
Yeah.
So I just correct it before it happens.
Oh, I love you. You're so great.
Oh, that's a speech impediment going on. Anyway, I'll trim some of that. This will all be.
No, it's fun stuff. Leave it.
I'll leave the fun stuff.
Okay.
Well, there's other words like George Bush has ruined nuclear for me because every once in a while I'll do nuclear.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I'll go, oh, I know that's not the way that word goes. But I get super self-conscious about nuclear before I say it. Like, I have a hesitation. There's, like, a half second where I'm like, how do I say that?
Yeah, that's one I've been guilty of.
Yeah, I've never really have, but I have friends that like to point it out,
mm-hmm.
and that bothers me some, so that I pay attention when I say it, even though you always say it right, just because I know that they're picky little
you
bad
have
words
friends,
like that.
Like, it's okay to correct somebody, but you have friends that enjoy pointing it out.
I know.
It makes them feel smart, and it makes you look foolish.
Yeah.
Which makes them look better. I don't know, but that's what irritates me.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Is there other Comic-Con stuff that we...
Oh, it seemed like there was so much.
Yeah.
Yeah, you went
did
to...
Did we talk about the Doctor Who trailer?
Mm-mm. I don't think we did.
Season 9?
Season 9. I'm sure I played it for you. The doctor's hair is a little messier. At some point, he's got sunglasses on.
He's got a guitar.
Yeah, he's got a guitar. I'm like, oh, we're going to get a little of the punk rock doctor.
Mm-hmm. I thought you were talking about the Lego one.
Oh, no.
That one's awesome, too.
Yeah, it is. I'm excited for that.
Batman and the Doctor were on the screen at the same time.
I know.
Yeah. What's not to like?
I'm really conflicted about that game, though. This Lego universe?
Dimensions?
Yeah.
Like, I love the idea. Like... Give me a game where I can play Doctor Who, like many of the doctors from Doctor Who.
Where you die and then you
regenerate to the
next new
one?
Doctor?
That's amazing!
Yes! Okay, sorry.
And Batman.
Uh-huh.
That's pretty awesome. But, like, that trailer is so bonkers. At a certain point, I'm like, oh, man, I don't know, because you see Homer Simpson in there.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, Doctor Who and the Simpsons, now you got a bridge too far. Like, I don't know, it's so bizarre.
But you also have, like, Doc Brown.
Oh.
The DeLorean and Doctor Who.
That's perfect.
Right?
That I love.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, that trailer, it is pretty awesome. It is pretty awesome.
If Doctor Who can go back in time and see cavemen and dinosaurs, he can go and see The Simpsons.
No.
Don't!
That's a different universe. That's a different dimension.
But that's it. It's supposed to be crossing dimensions into other places. And
I know. But The Simpsons...
It's going to be awesome.
...are yellow.
It's going to be
And they
awesome.
Only have yeah. four so fingers.
You know what used to be yellow? Lego people.
That's true.
Yep.
But yeah, no, it is pretty awesome, that trailer. That's just... And great marketing, because the companies that have done this have made a mint off directing this stuff at kids, but the whole... You have to buy the toy and put it on this little platform, and then you can play the character.
Yeah.
I hate that. Hate it.
Yeah.
But that's probably why they put
Doctor Who. I do want a Lego TARDIS, though.
Yeah, me too. That's why they put Doctor Who on Disney, I bet. But like, we're going to start airing Doctor Who on Disney, and then we're going to come out with this Disney, Doctor Who Lego game, which we'll advertise on Disney.
Well, that's
and
kind then... of interesting, because Disney has their own version of that whole thing.
Yeah, the Disney Infinity.
Yeah, which I don't think they have DC properties. I could be wrong.
No, they have Marvel.
They have Marvel stuff. Well, although Lego does have access to Marvel stuff at times, but I think Marvel's a little more selective. DC's just like, whatever, take them.
Yeah.
Do it. Give us money.
I was really surprised to see Doctor Who stuff show up on there, because... The BBC does tend to keep their grip on Doctor Who quite a bit tighter than a lot of companies do their properties.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But they wanted a Lego TARDIS, too.
Yeah, probably. They're just like, we just want a Lego TARDIS.
Well, and they are coming out with some sets, some Doctor Who Lego sets.
Oh, well, for sure they are. If they've got Doctor Who, there's going to be like 5,000 different sets, and that's awesome.
Mm-hmm. And that's, Yeah, it is kind of... That is awesome.
And, God, the Daleks were made to be Legos. Are you serious?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. They look like they were made.
They got those little things that you would step on and hurt yourself.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, at the end of the Season 9 trailer, you got Maisie Williams. And she, of course, is going to say something that's going to make every nerd Whovian wonder, like, who is she?
Yep.
And I'm sure it's so a red herring that is designed to send the fandom into a spiral, but it's like, was she Susan?
Yeah, exactly. That's the common theory.
Is she Romana? Is she the Ronnie? Is she?
Yep.
Is she Jenny?
I guess she was Susan.
Yeah, that's what you thought.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. But that was my first thought, and then someone else, I thought, I don't know, it seems a little off, and then someone else pointed out, Susan never referred to the doctor as old man. So it's like, well, okay, but if it's a new regeneration, maybe she's a little more sassy, who knows?
Well, and it seems like Moffat writing that Susan would call him old man.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a character we've never even met.
I'm actually guessing is that it's just a red herring.
Yeah.
The Ronnie or something like that would be pretty interesting.
Yeah.
Did we ever explain that my question was not stupid when I said, what is the Ronnie? Or what's a Ronnie? Because a Ronnie is something.
Mm-hmm. Okay. No, I don't think we did explain it.
Oh, yeah. A Ronnie is like the wife of the Sultan in
So the Ronnie is like a... Yeah, queen. It's a queen.
So the Ronnie's a queen. So when I said, what is a Ronnie? It was a valid question.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and so that the naming structure, we got Doctor, Master, Ronnie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They're all kind of like positions of prominence.
Yep.
Yep.
Hmm.
But yeah, the season series 9 trailer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it looked cool. I like the tone of it.
Zygons?
Mm-hmm.
Capaldi looks good with crazy hair.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Claire is still there, unfortunately.
Claire is still there. She's just had such a muddled run it just seems like they don't know what her character is.
Yeah, she's another freaking river song.
Yeah.
But I'm, obviously I'm excited. It's coming. Doctor Who.
Yeah.
By the time it's airing, we'll be all out of Doctor Who to watch, and that'll be the only new Doctor Who we can watch.
I know.
So we're into the Seventh Doctor,
mm-hmm.
and I think the Seventh Doctor and Ace is a fantastic combination.
They're wonderful. Yeah,
and not only that, I think Ace is just good in general. She would probably do well with many Doctors.
Ace is a good character, and I think part of what I really like about their dynamic is, and maybe this is like a reaction to the fan reaction to the previous Doctor, but mm-hmm. the Seventh Doctor, like, often, like, Ace will seem bummed out, and he'll stop and, like, you know, put the hand on the back and be concerned and be like, oh, you all right, or how's this going, or whatever.
Braveheart,
like,
Tegan.
like, there's, like, a... They have a good dynamic. So we were watching, The Greatest Show in the Galaxy?
Mm-hmm.
And at one point, I'm like, I could almost just watch this pair, like, travel around and not even, like, worry about the big plot of what the weekly problem is, you know? They're just kind of fun to, like, watch interact.
Mm-hmm.
They seem genuinely, like people, and they care about what the... Like, the Doctor cares about how she feels about things instead of, shut up, Perry.
Except in that one, he was kind of poking fun at her. He's like, oh, you're scared of clowns? Let's go to the circus, huh?
He was, but, you know, that's fun. Like, you gotta do that a little bit.
Yeah, I know. I enjoyed it.
But he even...
When Sophie and Sylvester actually hung out, I mean, like, they were pretty good mates off set.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, it shows. Yeah, that's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Mel was okay.
Meh.
Yeah,
she's grown on me in the, you know, like, I feel like Mel also benefits from Big Finish the way that the Colin Baker Doctor mm-hmm. benefited, and I even like the Colin Baker, I like the Sixth Doctor better now than I did when I was a kid,
mm-hmm.
But Mel also improves now, you know, like she needs a little time. And she needs to be mellowed out. And it's funny, I recently did that review for We Are the Daleks, which has Melanie Bush as the companion with the Seventh Doctor. And she even goes on to say in the behind the scenes that she realizes now, because she, you know, like, she really gets into it, she realizes now just how over the top she was.
Yeah.
And so, like, That's why I rated it so high, is that, yeah, she realizes it. She is better at playing Mel now than she was when she was actually playing Mel.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And I don't like the name.
You don't like the name? Oh. Why?
Why? I wonder.
Yeah. But, you know, and coming off of Perry, I liked Perry. And
I liked Perry, too. I didn't like the way the Doctor treated her.
No, I thought she had a horrible time. I hated how they left her character. Hated it.
Oh, yeah.
And so coming off of that, where I really like Perry, and it felt like the Doctor in the show itself just crapped all over that character all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And a little bit of that retains in some of the Big Finish stuff I've listened to with her and Colin Baker.
It depends on the era. It really depends. Like, if they're trying to emulate that era, they stick with it. Like, they go back to the well, and they say, okay, well, this is how they interacted. Some of the Lost Story stuff... evolves the character a smidge. But I think one of my favorites was the one where they go back in time to the Dalek invasion of Earth, where the Sixth Doctor is basically, he goes back in time, but he's in Scotland. And that all takes place after all the Trial of the Time Lord. He goes back and he finds Perry and he reunites with her. So it's actually post what would have happened in the show.
Oh, really?
And so then you get to see, you finally get to see a true evolution of the relationship between the Doctor and Perry.
Well, good, because I hate how they left her character.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's the queen of this man that she probably didn't want to be the queen of, because...
she didn't want anything to do with this guy.
No, she did not.
And they ended up leaving, she's happy. Look, there's a picture of her smiling with this barbarian. She's happy. No. She hated it.
Yeah.
She was... a young American girl who just wanted to go on an adventure, not live with a barbarian.
Yeah, and not be left as a freaking hostage every 5 seconds.
Yeah. So that's what is so refreshing about the Doctor's not like the Doctor. The Seventh Doctor's not like Ace. Go do this, and Ace is like, oh, this is like a horrible situation, and I could get like murdered. No, he's right, like he's like, do you want to go with them? And she's like, yeah. Or she's like, can I go over here? And he's like, are you sure? Like, there's a concern there, and
yeah, sure,
that's fun. Mm. And she likes explosives.
Yeah.
And she's, you know, she's younger still.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
She seems like one of the youngest companions, at least character age. I don't know how old the actress actually was.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's great.
It is great.
Oh, what was it? It's the trilogy that takes over after the Trial of the Time Lord, where he goes back and saves Perry, is The Widow's Assassin is the first one. And then it's Masters of Earth is the one I was trying to think of. And then it ends with the return of the Rani, with the Rani elite.
Oh, okay.
So that is 192. So it's a relatively recent one.
I'll have to track those down. I think the Seventh Doctor, I mean, there are some stories that are not great, but I think the Seventh Doctor's run is one of my favorite.
Uh-huh. And it's all, but and part of it is how bizarre some of the episodes are. I enjoy that. Mm-hmm. It makes it interesting.
He's got his own flair too. It doesn't mm-hmm. feel like he's trying to ape any other previous incarnation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but he looks weird without a hat.
He does.
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry.
that'll be different when you guys see the movie too, because they change his character up a little bit. He's been traveling alone for a while.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm.
Have you? Where are you guys at? Are you? You're not. I assume you're not to Curse of Fenric yet, then.
No. I think we watched the first episode of Battlefield last night.
No, we watched...
Or the second episode of Battlefield.
We watched the first two, yeah.
Okay. The next up is Ghostlight.
Oh, this is where things change between him and Ace.
Uh-oh.
But I was just praising it.
It's interesting. And it starts going in and it's not bad. I mean, it's the way you'd need to evolve their relationship.
See, this is where everything you just said, Randy, changes. Where yeah. everything you just said was wrong.
Yeah, so get excited. Everything you love is going to end. No, I mean, but they dig into Ace's backstory more.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Yeah, there's two more stories after that, the one you mentioned, and another one I can't remember.
Ghostlight, Fenric, mm-hmm. and then the one I've got the last one. The last one is Survival. Survival's a little it's interesting. but that's one where it's like, yeah, watch all the special features if you can find them, because there's a lot of fun backstory or you know, like read about that final episode, because... Yeah, actually, one of the characters in that final episode goes on to play Bernice Summerfield.
Oh, interesting.
In all the Big Finish stuff, so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then it's Eric Roberts' Master, and that's then we're done with it.
Yeah.
I was trying to find when I started watching the classic series, but Get Glue is defunct, and I don't know if I started checking into it right away anyway. But it was somewhere around 2000, probably 11.
When some of those probably synced up to Facebook, so you might be able to track it down on your old Facebook timeline, mm-hmm. but that might take a while.
Well, I think you can like separate, because I think it would have, maybe it sometimes would just do a regular post. But some of it I know it, like you can separate the apps, like posts by apps.
Oh, okay.
So that might be my best bet. But at least 2012, maybe into 2011, is when I started watching the classic series.
Yeah.
And we're almost done. It's taken a while.
Mm-hmm. But, you know.
Well, it's only 50. Yeah,
it's only 50 years.
50
worth of
years
stuff.
Of television crammed into a couple.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey there. Did you know, you two, that we have a YouTube channel?
We do.
We do.
We do?
We do.
I
we do.
Yeah. I did.
Well, I bet you do, because you're on it.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
So if you go to youtube.com/Grawlix Podcast, not only can you listen to older episodes of the show, with chapter skips.
Woo!
Woo!
But there's also all kinds of like bonus stuff.
Hey, Randy.
Yeah.
What about the interviews?
There's interviews with creative types. You can catch our interviews with comic book creators, webcomic creators, podcasters, or even just fans. We love all areas of nerddom, and we want to talk to everybody. This is bad. What do you guys have to say about the YouTube channel?
I think video is the way of the future. I think it's going to render our podcast obsolete.
Well, we better hurry up and get on there.
Yeah, we better.
Jump in it.
We're going to jump in it.
Jump in it. Subscribe to your jump in. What? What does that even mean?
What we're trying to say is you can catch episodes of the Grawlix Podcast, our interviews we do as Grawlix Knights, our Cranky Old Men of Comics version, Cranky Old Men of Comics rants as Grawlix Bites, as well as other things. And the nice thing about YouTube is maybe you don't want to hear all this random banter that we're prone to. You just want to hear us talk about Swamp Thing or The Walking Dead. You can click a little thing on the screen. Takes you right to it.
Bam, you're there.
The future.
Instant gratification.
In the future.
You could skip right to what you want to hear.
The future is now. Get over there.
We've also got reviews and other exclusive things that you're not going to hear in our podcast feed.
We don't talk about community like we did today.
But on YouTube, we're all about it. Chat us up on there. We'll talk to you. We talk.
We'll argue with you.
We'll talk to you.
We'll make you tell us something constructive about your criticism.
Yeah.
Listen, guys, no promises that I'm going to talk to you, but do it anyways.
Do it anyway.
Just do it. Oh, wait, that's Nike.
You want to spend 7 paragraphs talking about the relationship of Jeff and Annie on Community? Well, I'll do it for some reason. I will engage in that conversation.
Do it.
Truth.
Truth.
All right. Well, hey, don't forget, send us some love mail at letters@grawlixpodcast.com. Mm-hmm. If you send us an email, we'll read it on the show. Yeah.
Hey, Randy, what if they send us like a MP3?
Oh, my God. That's the future.
They could email us MP3s even, couldn't they?
They could. In fact, we encourage it. No, that'd be awesome. Like, we want to hear, like, we'll put your voice on the show.
That's how serious we are about hearing you.
We will make, we'll give you a button, and we'll just repeatedly push that button.
Over and over.
Yeah, we'll make you a soundbite.
No, if you want to...
Are we like, underwhelmingly selling this?
I think we're overwhelmingly underwhelming. That's a great idea. We'd love to incorporate something like that in the show. If you want to send us a two-minute or less clip, because that seems to work for other shows. If you want to send us an audio clip, ask us a question, tell us what you thought about something we discussed recently, or just, like, what's your favorite reads recently? Tell us something we should be checking out.
Mm-hmm.
Send us an MP3 clip. Record it. Well, actually, you should record it and then send it.
That's easier.
A little less sci-fi. Just try to keep it, you know, G, PG.
Don't make us have to Grawlix you.
Yeah, don't make us slap a Grawlix on it.
Right.
And don't forget to vote on our poll list picks.
That's right. Visit GrawlixPodcast.com. About halfway down the page, on the left, in the right sidebar, you'll see a poll. Give us your opinion. Vote on something that other people have already voted for, or throw your own voice in the ring. You can recommend something for us to read.
Yeah.
Every month we pick whichever has the highest votes, so we read it the next month and talk about it. That's how it works.
Yep.
Every vote counts, and every voice matters.
It's true. And then And then we read the voices.
Yes, all comic readers.
This is what happens when we only read one book. makes sure, you guys make sure we read more than one book in the future.
Yeah. Now that reminds us, next month we will be talking once again, as we mentioned, about Herald, Lovecraft, and Tesla, as well as Walking Dead Volume 3.
Ooh. Yep. So don't miss it, because it'll be awesome.
Oh, hey, this is kind of marginally related to something we're doing right now. So I worked on another album. I know we've talked about some of my music in the past. I've got another one coming out. It's been a year since I come out with the first one. I figured,
wow.
Yeah, I know. I figured it's about time to do another one. Mm-hmm. So Control Alt Destroy is the artist name. It's spelled not exactly how it sounds. I'll have a link in the show notes, but, the album's called Blood.
Ooh.
And it's kind of inspired by 80s vampire movies and such.
Oh, cool.
It's kind of got... I mean, I tried to, like, convey that type of tone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Near Dark, Fright Night.
Lost Boys.
Well, I was about to say, not so much young adolescent males that can't be found, just because I have not seen that movie as many times as most people probably have, but
sure,
that too. That's like everyone's go-to 80s vampire.
Right.
So I'll claim it. But but that album will be up by the time you... that album will be up Friday, July 31st. 1 year and 1 day since the last album.
Wow.
It's like the ghost slasher killer that comes back a year after you did something bad.
Uh-huh.
Did you plan it that way?
No. Nope.
Like, are you premeditatedly serial killing years?
It is premeditated by about a week.
Oh, awesome.
This is something that I've kind of, like, has been mostly ready, but there's been, like, last-minute things and all this other stuff that... I've been slowly working on, and since, you know, we work on other things at times, so I finally had to be like, I need a date. What's a good date? Oh yeah, my album came out a year ago. I'll pick this date. And I wanted it to be a summer release, and so I need to hurry up and slide it in there.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I'm pretty happy with the album. There's like, I'll say 7 to 8 new original tracks, and then like a whopping 5 remixes by different awesome synthwave artists. People that I've never worked with before. The Warhorse, Panda PI, which is like the greatest name ever.
Yeah.
That is pretty awesome, yeah.
A bunch of cool stuff. So that'll be out. You can check it out at ctrlaltdstry.bandcamp.com. That'll be the most direct route to it. It'll also be available on iTunes, Google Play, the other ones. The other ones.
All
the other
them.
Things.
It'll be, Amazon.com. It'll be available for digital download. If you want to go to that Bandcamp, you'll get the best deal there. I always be sure, because that's more direct from me. So I always be sure to give the best deal there. But also, you can listen to the whole thing for free there. So if you, you don't have to pay for it, you could just go listen to it. I'm more than happy for that. Yeah, and if you dig it, check out my other album, Redeemer, came out a year ago.
Sweet.
Randy wants to play I Know What You Did Last Summer.
Yeah, apparently. Which is weird. Which is, no, it's actually kind of appropriate, because that's very much a 90s throwback to the 80s. A lot like me.
And The Crow.
Yeah, wow. Yeah, it's all for a full circle.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That's the thing we do.
Yeah.
Usually accidentally, but it works.
Yep. Is it really so much about intent or how it's perceived?
Well, that's an existential quandary.
I was really wondering what, like, kind of response. I was staring at Melanie, and she just, like, stopped totally still and just stared at me.
That's like Cure lyrics.
This is Randy. They're coming to get you, Grawlix.
and this is Melanie, and Greed is for Amateurs. Disorder, Chaos, Anarchy, now that's Grawlix.
And this is Jesse. I solemnly Grawlix that I am up to no good.
Thank you for listening to the Grawlix Podcast. The Grawlix Podcast is a production of Electronic Media Collective and Vocal Arrow Studios. This podcast is released under a Creative Commons Attribution, Non-Commercial, No Derivatives, 4.0 International License. To hear more, visit GrawlixPodcast.com. Follow us on Facebook at Facebook.com/GrawlixPodcast and like us on Twitter at Twitter.com/GrawlixPodcast.
All right, I don't know how well that went, but it's something.
Yeah.
All right.
Well,
that's it for this episode of the Grawlix Podcast.
That's it.
It's so final.
This is it. No more Grawlix.
Whoa.
For a whole month.
Okay.
Well, no promises. You can get... there's a lot of... You can...